when he took the job and got the job at LR, Grayson Willingham was the first phone call he made. And Grayson has been on board ever since day one. And the leadership that he has shown, not only with the winning and the rah-rah stuff, but all the other leadership qualities we know that he has helped that transition into the new program.
Yeah, Grayson Willingham has been the winningest quarterback and set most of the records, and the ones he doesn't have, he'll have by the end of the year. A great leader. He works extremely hard. That's one thing every coach that's had Grayson has told anybody that would listen, that he works very hard. He sets a good example for the rest of the team, and that's what a leader has to do. But that has a quarterback leader, that's especially important, because you know they wind up being the focal point so much of the offense nowadays with the spread offenses everybody runs. Everybody's pointing to that quarterback,
and he has been nothing short of sensational for the Bears since taking over first as a starter in 2018. The Matthews, North Carolina native, and Wennington High School outside of Charlotte, super senior Grayson Willingham. You know, the Bears last week and that win over Carson Newman, and you've seen two of the biggest blowouts against Carson Newman, Jack, since back in 2010 when the Bears snapped a 31-year losing streak against them, and then last week beating Carson Newman, 750 total yards. Somebody asked me, is that the most yards that LR's ever gotten in an offensive game? And I said, no, it wasn't. I can tell you who it was against and the year it was against, but I'll let Josh let you talk about those honors.
Well, we had a great game down at Davidson in 1975, and you know, we were only, just think about this, we only could take one bus. We had 44 players. We had the top two on offense and defense, and that's it. You know, had to put the kicker and the long snapper in a van with the managers to get down there. So we only had two teams, and we jumped out on Davidson early in the game, and we had a really good offensive team at that year. And we jumped out ahead of them, and when we put the second unit in there, they had a fantastic day. They played almost a full half of the game in there, and we wound up with 837 yards rushing. And Chip Sheffield's still mad at me because we only threw the ball twice, I think, in the game. He caught a couple for 37 yards. So we had a total offense that day of 914 yards, and the 837 is still a record for rushing.
In all of college football.
In all of college football.
D1, D2, yeah. D3, NAIA, the whole shebang, and LR holds that specific record. And that kind of story, Jack, and others are as being portrayed in the book Bear Nation Between the Bricks, just out today.
Yeah, that great book. I just got my copy of it, and David Stevens, the author, was up at the Shaw Plaza selling the school selling the books. David donated the books to the university so they could sell them and use the money for the stadium renovation. So we're really excited about it, and hopefully David's going to make his way up here at halftime, and we'll talk to him about that. But you mentioned the two Carson Newman games, and I'll never forget in 2010 you were unable to make that trip for whatever reason, and you said that's one of your great big regrets you've ever had in football. Because I really point to that game. That game in my mind was the turning point when Fred Goldsmith had done what he needed to do, the coaching staff, the players were in place, and from that point on in the rest of the 2000s, the Bears were, you know, the best in the league. I mean, no question about it. And I think that game was the turning point. When we proved that we could play that well on the road at Carson Newman, the perennial power, everything has been uptick for the Bears.
Yeah, winning a decade, making the playoffs, going to the national championship game, numerous playoff appearances in just a phenomenal decade plus. We started a new decade. The Bears come into this game today 4-2, 3-2 in the sack. 1-2 in a row, while Limestone comes in winless on the season, 0-5 and 0-3 in the South Atlantic Conference. Want to pause for 1 second and mention this. We're going to dedicate this broadcast, Jack, to our friend, loyal listener, researcher, former Piedmont Education Foundation president, and LR alum, Paul Bullock. We lost Paul last weekend. Paul, rest in peace. We know you're listening. He's in the true land of milk and honey.
You got that right, Paul. We miss you, and we are very, very proud to do this game in your honor.
So we're ready to about set for the kickoff. The Bears are in black today with those chrome-looking helmets, the bright Cardinal helmets with the LR on it, all black uniforms with the white numbers. And again, limestone in all white helmets as well. The Saints out of Gaffney.
Great contrast now, you know.
Yeah.
And I've told you many times, I love that when I was throwing the football. You got such a contrast, you can't get them mixed up. You know who you're throwing to.
And the Bears are going to receive the football. We don't know yet about Limestone's starting quarterback. They've been through a couple already. We understand that they're going to be at. They've added some players that have not even appeared on the roster until today.
Well, and something else to remember, Juju, in this game, Limestone has nothing to lose.
No, they don't.
And so, you know, an onside kick right here wouldn't surprise me. A fake punt, a fake field goal, a fake anything. Nothing that Limestone would do today would surprise me. The Bears have to stay on the alert offensively and defensively for anything because they have nothing to lose and everything to gain.
And if you're listening to us back out in the tailgate area, if you're here between the bricks and listening, thank you for listening. If you're at home, pull up the chair, get a cold one ready, and we're set to kick it off today as Limestone will kick it to the closed end here at Moret Stadium. And the kick is away, and we are underway. Bears and Limestone. Lester has the return at the 5-yard line. Dre Lester gets over the 20 before he is wrapped up and pushed backward at about the 22. And set the Bear offense for you. Record-setting quarterback Grayson Willingham will start at QB, a senior out of Matthews. He'll be right behind him, the running back Dwayne McGee, freshman out of Kissimmee, Florida. He is only a skosh shy of 1,000 yards rushing, I think less than 25 yards rushing to get over 1,000 in his freshman year. Xavier Jennings, Ryan Franz, Blake Jefferson, Shane Wells, and Ian Brinson will be the offensive line. We'll set the rest for you at wide receiver, Ryan Carter, Kellen Parsons, and Dre Lester. Here we go. We are underway. The Bears have it going right to left. Hand off McGee, running left, trying to cut the corner. Splits through a couple of men before he is drugged down from behind at about the 28. Good pickup, though. A gain of 5 on first down. Dwayne McGee, second down and 5 for the Bears. Just underway. Homecoming 2021 here at LR.
Perfect example of how Dwayne McGee makes that offense look good. Looked like we were kind of stymied right there. He made a little in-out move. Next thing you know, he picks up 6 yards.
Second down, receivers to both sides, 2 to the right. Play action over here. Complete pass. Willingham gets it to Lester. He spins out.
Oh,
there's
a
late hit. Waiting for the flag, and here he came. Kind of a defenseless receiver got stood up and right on the sidelines there. He got nailed, and here comes the flag. It'll be 15. Lester did have enough for the first down as he fell forward before being knocked out of bounds at about the 34. So we'll tack on another 15, and that'll put the Bears close to midfield on this first drive. Again, LR coming in on the season offensively, averaging almost 38 points a game. They have a total offense of close to 500 a game, number one in the sack, as the personal foul on the late hit goes against Limestone. Limestone comes in with the worst defensive record in the South Atlantic Conference, so you got the number one offense against the number one defense. One way to get the momentum, Jack, is to would do what the Bears have done a few times this year, and that is get on the board in a hurry.
Yeah, and the Bears taking the ball down the field. I think in every game but one, we've scored on our opening possession.
Yeah.
And that was the last time here at home when against Tusculum when we drove it down the field and then fumbled. And the Bears got a targeting call and the penalty on that play. And it should have been. That was just a vicious late hit out of bounds. There was no question about the penalty. And they added on the targeting, too.
Three receivers split out. Godwin is the tight end, goes left to right. Lester goes in motion, gets the jet sweep, spins through, breaks a couple of tackles before he is wrapped up near the line of scrimmage and pushed back. That'll be a loss of 1. Second down and 11. The ball's at the 48, but that time got good penetration from Limestone and forced Lester and the Bear offense to operate behind the chains now.
Yeah, DeAndre Lester's not a running back by trade, and he just took a bad play and made it worse. He couldn't get outside. He bumped into people, came back inside and ran into him and made it worse for a 1-yard loss.
Willingham will take a straight jump, and he throws the pass. It looks like it fell through the hands of Lester. Close, it would have been close to a first down, but it's incomplete. It went through his hands. I don't look like, Jack, that perhaps it may have hit his knee or his shoulder pad, but it bounced out of there. He should have had a completion.
Yeah, here comes the replay. We get a chance to look at this again. It looked like the ball was thrown low, but he may have thrown it low on purpose. But, you know, as he dove for the ball went through his arms and hit in his lower body, and I think you're right. It just went right through his arms and hit down on his knees and kicked it out.
Third and 11, Bears send three out in the pattern. Willingham down the field, caught. This time Parsons came back to him, picks up the first down. He is drugged down inside the 20, down to about the 16, and a big play. I like what they did. They came right back to Parsons.
No, that was Lester.
Oh, that was Lester. Excuse
yeah.
me.
They ran a crossing route. That's what they did. They used Parsons as the clear-out guy.
Okay.
And they brought Parsons underneath, and boy, I mean Lester underneath, and boy, was he open, and a great throw by Grayson right down the pipe.
About a 35-yard pickup. Here's a quick pass to the tight end, and he's upended. That's Godwin. He was upended before he picked up about two on the play. John Godwin out of Jacksonville, Florida. The freshman.
We used that play last week. It's kind of a tight end, almost like a tight end screen. And we used it last week several times. It didn't go a couple times. A couple times we picked up some good yards on it.
Trying to make that Limestone defense be honest and at least look for that play. Here's a delayed handoff to McGee. Spins out of there at the 10 before he is drugged down. Good play by Limestone secondary. Kendarius Frederick out of Rock Hill, South Carolina, redshirt senior, makes the play. A couple of those guys in the secondary, Jack, some transfers. They got some veteran players there.
Yeah, they've got, I think I counted this week when I saw their lineup, I think they had like, at the time, they had nine transfers starting on defense. And that was a heck of a play because McGee had popped it, and he was going to score down the left sideline over here if it had not been for the young man coming from the backside to catch him.
Bears are taking the opening kickoff. 3 minutes gone. Willingham throws the pass. Incomplete.
Field goal.
Here comes the field goal. That was on third down. Intended for Parsons. Again, a low throw. Fell incomplete. So here comes record-setting kicker Chase Elbaugh. Tallahassee, Florida graduate player. He's on to attempt about a 28-yard field goal. They'll place it at the 18 from the left hash.
Thanks to our buddy Jim Sprouse down in Tallahassee, where he lives. He sent us some information on the school. Remember last game where up
and good. It is good. 28 yards went to a Florida high school, which is on the campus of Florida State.
Right, where Chase Elbaugh, kind of like the Christian school over here with Lenore Ryan, is kind of tied in. And obviously they had a sports program, too, to go along and play football.
So the Bears get on the board just over 3 minutes in the first quarter. It's LR3 and Limestone nothing. Stay with us. This is LR Football on WSVM Radio. Face it, you're happy.
Moret Stadium is an iconic part of LR Athletics. Hosting games, tailgating, marching band competitions, sports camps, and graduation ceremonies, the stadium serves as a valued focal point for the greater Hickory area. The time has come to renovate the stadium to allow LR to continue to offer our student athletes, fans, and the community an exceptional experience.
Paramount Kia in Hickory. We want to see you driving a new Kia or, hey, a quality pre-owned Kia. We've got a huge selection of new and pre-owned Kias. You got to get to Paramount Kia in Hickory, Highway 70, ParamountKia.com.
Back here, Juju Phillips, Jack Huss, ready for the kickoff. Bears on the board first. 28-yard field goal from Chase Elbaugh, and there's a low kick, and there's a fumble on the play, and the Bears coming with a big hit on the special teams after the kickoff cut kind of muffed down about the 13-yard line.
Well, that ball hit the ground, and the receiver said, well, I think it's going out of bounds. So he was just kind of standing there waiting for the ball to go out of bounds, and it spun back in bounds. And by then, we had somebody right on top of him, and it's fortunately for him, he was able to recover it because that ball was going to be the Bears at about the 14-yard line. A little unusual play, but the Bears have had some unusual plays on kickoffs this year already.
Brian Turk is the head coach at Limestone. He's been there a little over 2 years, 4-18 overall record, and is a former assistant at South Carolina. And they get a handoff to their maybe their best player, Jerica Patton. And he is a redshirt senior out of Charlotte. And he picks up four on the play, second down. Patton has been an all-conference player for Limestone. And he's hurt the Bears in a couple of games. You recall back in 2019, the last time these two teams played in Gaffney, Jack, the Bears trailed Limestone at halftime. Here's a quick pass over here. It is caught. 25-yard line, nearly breaking through, is the wide receiver. Coming in is Hector, senior out of Stapleton, Georgia. But that's a first down for Limestone to the 30.
Great throw by Ethan Beamish, number 16, the starting quarterback, a 5'10", 185-pound freshman from A.C. Flora High School in Simpsonville. And I tell you what, he put some heat on that ball. That was an excellent throw and catch.
First and 10, back to pass again. Throws it downfield, high throw off the hands of the receiver. Intended down there for number one, and that is Ellison. And he had his hands on it. It would have been way enough for a first down. The Bears had pretty close coverage. The ball falls incomplete, 10:54 to go in the first. Bears lead it here 3-0.
Looked like a zone coverage, and J.P. Palmer was the man that came in from behind and knocked that ball loose. Good coverage because, you know, most teams have found success throwing against our corners, but we may be playing a little bit more zone today, especially against this freshman.
Beamish again making his first start as a college quarterback. Here's a delayed handoff to Patton, and he is just covered up in the backfield. Going to be a loss of about two on the play. One thing about that Bear defense, Jack, they came into this game giving up less than 100 yards a game rushing. I'm not sure how many teams have actually dedicated to running the football, but the Bears have been stout against the rush this year.
Yeah, John Ross May back in there again today. We hadn't seen him for a while. I don't know if it was an injury or not, but he's back in there today. Played some last week, and I tell you, he can really run the field. He can get you from sideline to sideline.
DeAndre Shelton and Andre Jefferson at defensive ends today. Here he comes on the pass rush. Quarterback had to get it away, and a big hit over on the far side by Palmer, intended for one of the receivers, Hector, and a big hit by Palmer, but not before. I believe that was Shelton coming off the edge, the Macon, Georgia sophomore defensive end for the Bears. Put on the heat, and that'll force Limestone to kick it away.
The Bears had a great play call on defense here. They brought pressure. They got to the quarterback. He made a good throw, but J.P. Palmer had read the play and was up right on top of him to make the hit. That's a just good all-around defensive play, and starting with a great play call by your defensive coordinator.
Three and out now for Limestone, kicking it away for Limestone as Potts off the side of his foot. Bears are going to get great field position. Now back for LR was Ryan Carter, but he did not even come close to receiving the ball, and it's going to be marked up near midfield, about the 45.
I think the official got lost in our bench over here, and the referee couldn't find me to point to the proper place. We got a TV timeout, Juju. How about that?
I guess we're the South Atlantic Conference game of the week. Though the other big game is Virginia Wise hosting Wingate. Wingate on top, last report, Jack, at halftime. The game's now probably in the second half as Wingate leading that game 31-13. Hey, we'll take a break as well. Come right back. Stay with us. Bears on top here, 3-0. This is LR Football on WSVM Radio. After the TV timeout, Bears on top 3-0. They get the ball for the second time here this afternoon. Homecoming, the 80th homecoming, and a nice crowd on hand. The band, the student section in the end zone, and the sun side of the field, the east side here at Moret Stadium, starting to fill up. And, of course, the home side is practically filled, and still the behind us during the tailgate is also pretty full. Here's a handoff to McGee. He's running with the football far side in front of the right hash. He gets it up the midfield. That's a pickup of five for Dwayne McGee, who's approaching 1,000 yards rushing, Jack, trying to become just the 24th running back in LR or quarterback in LR history to rush for 1,000 yards in a season. He's still got almost four games to go.
He had 200 yards right on the button last week in an outstanding effort, and shared the rest of that with two other freshman tailbacks that came in.
And a tied a school record, five touchdowns. Here's McGee again on a delayed pattern and a run, and he gets it over the 45-yard line. That should be enough for a first down. It'll be a six-yard pickup before he's thrown backwards. So a first down for McGee and the Bears as they move the chains at the 44.
McGee got thrown down kind of awkwardly, and he's coming out of the game, but I don't like the way he's kind of coming off the field. We may not see him back in for a series or two. And then they'll have to, you know, coach's not going to take any chances with him. We've got two other good running backs, but Dwayne McGee is the bell cow right now as far as the running backs go.
There's a quick toss over here to Jadis Davis, the backup running back, and he takes his speed and splits through a couple of defenders off the nice little pass to the 30-yard line. Just a little dump-off pass to Davis, and he picks up 15 and a Bear first down.
It's just great to have all three of these guys. Last week for the first time we saw Jacoby Lane come in also with Jadis Davis. They all look similar, but they can all run with the football.
Add in Sturdivant, too, as well. Here's a play action. Willingham complete across the middle. That's Ryan Carter, and that's another first down for the Bears. Down to the 15. That'll be a pickup of another 15 yards, and the Bears are clicking on this second series.
The success of the running game, the quick pass, and then we go to a play-action pass, and Grayson Willingham, just the offensive line, great job. He just had all kinds of time to sit there in the pocket and pick that receiver. He let Ryan Carter run all the way across the field and then just threw a strike.
Will do. Thank you, Leslie. Got a nice text from Leslie Kenworthy, and the Bears marching here. First and 10 at the 15. Turn, hand it off to Davis, looking for a hole, head down, straight up the middle, and he'll get it down to about the 11. That's a pickup of four on first down. Second down for the Bears, halfway through the first quarter here at homecoming. LR on top here, 3-0, but going right to left to the opened end here, the northern end at Moret Stadium. Trying to get into the end zone for the first time this afternoon.
Jadis Davis again running with his eyes. He ran to the right. It was closed up. He just bounced to the left, just one man over. And, boy, when he did, it was all over.
Here's a reverse running with the ball, upended before he gets down to about the four. That's Lester coming on a reverse, the sophomore out of Washington, Georgia. And that'll be good enough for a first down. So the Bears going into their, I'll say, bag of tricks, but going maybe a little deeper into the playbook, Jack, down here on the goal line, running a reverse. And the Bears get a first down, first and goal, just inside the five.
Chris Williams, a redshirt junior safety, made a saving tackle. If he doesn't make that tackle, you know, he's going into the end zone standing up. That was an excellent play call.
Willingham lofts it over here in the end zone and complete. Nice play by the defensive back, Frederick, once again, the Rock Hill, South Carolina, and Citadel transfer. Just knocked it away over there for the far side in front. I think that was Lester again. So it's second down, stops the clock, 6:57 to go here in the first. Bears on top here, 3-0.
Trying to run the little fade route over there in the corner you see so much on TV, but that one didn't look very good.
Turn and pitch. Davis slips through one man way in the backfield before he's then spun and knocked down at about the 7. That's going to be a loss on the play of 2. It could have been worse, though.
Well, the Bears' goal line offense hasn't looked too good so far. We got stymied down here last time, and now we're third down, lost a couple of yards. We're third down at about the 8-yard line. that we have to score or go for the field goal again. And again, it was a toss sweep to the loaded side, and they had a guy break through. We got two great breaks. Number one, Jadis Davis didn't get tackled. Looked like it was going to take about a 10-yard loss. And then we had a play that I thought could have been called a clip, and they didn't call it. So we got two big breaks on that.
Third and goal, back to pass. Willingham looking down the middle of the field. High throw, incomplete. I don't know if anybody was open. Intended for Parsons across the middle there, but the Bears now going to have to settle for another field goal attempt. Two series, and now their second field goal attempt, leading here 3-0.
Yeah, Limestone's got to feel real good about that. The Bears been down there twice now, and the best they've been able to do is get a field goal on one in this attempt right here. But, you know, the Bears just didn't have a good series of plays either time once they got to the scoring zone.
Ball's on the left hash at about the 15. That's a 25-yard field goal, and he missed it. Chase Elbaugh missed it from the left side, the 25. So the Bears have had the ball practically about all of this first quarter except for three plays, and LR only leads. They've driven it twice inside the red zone, only come away with 3 points. 3-0 in favor of the Bears. Back with more. This is Bear Sports Network presented by MBA Roofing on WSVM Radio.
Hey, Panther Nation.
Doesn't matter who you are, Everett has you covered. Proud sponsor of the LRB.
Here quickly after the missed field goal, the Bears now on defense, trying to slow down Limestone. 3-0 in favor of the Bears. There's a running play by the Saints on the first play, and it stopped for nearly no gain on the far side. Second and 10 now for the Saints.
The Bear defense has been rested because the Bears took the opening kickoff and moved it down the field. They took the second possession, moved it down the field. So the Bear defense is rested, and they just really look good right there. They completely throttled any type of that running game quick outside.
Ethan Beamish is the quarterback, making his first collegiate start, and he was under pressure, scrambles out, then hit as he throws it away. Hit pretty strongly over there by Jefferson and Shelton on the edges over there, and it's going to bring up a second down and 10 after, a third down now.
Yeah.
Third down, and after Beamish was lucky to get away from that initial surge.
Amari Houston is beside himself. He had him sacked, and that's a freshman for you. We had him sacked, and somehow he came out of that. You know, we've seen some great freshmen come here and unsung and may have some great performances on Moret Stadium and on John David Moose Field. We don't want to see one of those again today.
I think Amari and the quarterback are both from Simpsonville, South Carolina. Here's a pass incomplete in front of the LR bench intended for the receiver over there. I believe that was Hector, and it falls incomplete. Bears had good coverage. No, that was Ellison. So three and out again for Limestone.
Zadarius Kelly in a good position.
Yep.
The Bears, again, have had trouble with the corners, but our corners have covered exceptionally well today.
Bears have had a long streak, like 47, 48 games where they've had at least one sack, and I think Amari Houston thought he should have had another. But that's going to force a punt now, and J.B. Potts, who's a freshman out of York, South Carolina, will kick it away, standing at his own five, back for the Bears. Receiving is Ryan Carter. He'll get it at his 39, fumbles the football, stripped loose, but I think he fell on it. Yes, he did. So the Bears catch a break here after Carter was hit, stripped of the football, but fell on it at the 37.
Ryan Carter's been he's been excellent on returning kicks this year, both kickoffs and punts. And he took a little bit of a chance. There was somebody bearing down on him, but he knew if he caught that ball and that initial tackler missed him, which he almost did, then he was going to be able to run for good yardage. But, you know, the next tackler was right in behind it, and the original tackler got an arm on him, and next thing you know, he's having to fall on a loose ball.
5 minutes to go, 5:09 to be exact, here in the first quarter. Bears 3-0. Play action. Nope, they hand it off to Davis, running right side around the edge. He gets the first down, showing his speed on the far edge over there in front of the Limestone bench in the Sunside here at Moret Stadium. Jadis Davis picks up about 13 and a Bear first down.
Yeah, Davis is coming out of the game, and Dwayne McGee's back in there. It's good to see. I was a little worried about Dwayne when he went out, but, you know, we lose a little bit. But I tell you, Jadis Davis is an excellent back. We don't lose that much.
Wingate, North Carolina native is Davis. Here's McGee. He has found a hole at the 30, at the 25. We're sprinting down the sidelines and goes for the end zone.
Oh, did he get it? Oh, he reached.
Pylon is knocked down. They're going to say stepped out at the 3.
He's moving it back to the 3. I'll tell you what, I thought he got down there close enough, and he, one of those Sunday TV deals, he reached that ball out with his left hand, and I thought he might have got it in, but he stepped out at the 4.
About a 50-yard scamper. I mean, he went right through that hole, as we'll see it on the replay. I mean, he's a zip right through the hole, and he was in the secondary and nearly outran everybody. Great effort by McGee. Comes right back on the field and peels off about a 50-yard run. The Bears are back for the third time here the first quarter on touchdown's doorstep. First and goal at the 3. They'll give it to McGee this time. Can he get in?
Got to be in first. Now. Got to be in.
Close. No S.
There you
touchdown.
Go.
McGee, Dwayne McGee, gets into the land of milk and honey. And the Bears are on the board again. It's LR9 and Limestone nothing.
McGee is so small. Once he got in the end zone with all that pile of humanity around him, the official had to come all the way in to see that he was laying in the end zone before it was they unpiled.
That young man is over 1,000 yards rushing, probably the earliest someone's gone over 1,000 yards in LR history, or at least one of the earliest times. He and Leonard Davis probably are the two earliest. And here's the extra point by Elbaugh, who has been almost nearly automatic for the better part of 3 years. And it's good. 10-0 Bears on top here. Just under 4 minutes to go in the first quarter. Stay with us. It's homecoming this afternoon between the Bricks on the campus of LR here at Barrett Stadium. And you're listening and watching to the Bears Sports Network, presented by MBA Roofing and on WSVM Radio.
Quality work.
A toast to our Bears.
Back here, the Bears get their first touchdown of the afternoon. Lead it here 10-0. As Owen will kick it off, Michael Owen, the punter, angles it to the left side. Ball's fumbled at about the 12, running left on the far side, and the Bears come up and make a nice stop on the play. Good coverage by the LR secondary, or the LR special teams. Jaquez Due, backup linebacker, freshman out of Whitfield Academy in Ellenwood, Georgia, on the stop. So looks like Limestone's third possession of this football game. They're going to be way backed up at about their own 12.
The classic mistake, Juju.
Yeah.
Every time you ever heard me say it, they kicked the ball to this side of the field right here in front of us. And the return was set up to the other side, so he ran laterally across the field. That's never a good thing. You never gain yardage when you're running sideways. You got to be going north and south.
He was told what to do. That's where the play set up, but he'd have been best smarter just to run it straight ahead.
Yeah, that's where that special teams coach has got to tell him, if it's kicked that far offline, you take it up the other side and get all you can.
Yeah. Limestone has had 6 plays and no first downs here in the first quarter, and they run it to Patton. Straight up the middle, May on the stop for the Bear defense, gain of about 1.
They had 1 first down on that pass, remember, early in the game?
Oh, yeah.
And that's it. Bears have 9 first downs in the first quarter. We had 40 in a game this year.
Last week?
40.
That's a sack
that
record.
Last week, yeah, 40 first downs. We broke some big plays, but we didn't have those 80- and 90-yard runs. We did it on 20- and 30-yard runs and had 40 first downs. That's phenomenal.
So 46 years in the sack, most yards ever. And first, well, not most yards ever, but most first downs in a game. Swing pass over here caught by Limestone, far sideline, inside the 20. It's going to be that right at the 20. It's going to be a pickup of about five on the play, third down and about two.
That's a play that the Bears have had trouble with all year with everybody, and of course they see the video, but he ran that, the pass play was everybody down the field, and then they just flared the tailback out to the weak side, and we had no coverage over there. Our coverage had run off with the wide receiver, so there was nobody over there to cover the back, and that was an easy 7 or 8 yard gain.
Safety Eric Jackson on the stop for the Bears. They bunch the formation left side, and they run it that way. That's Patton. He hits the front wall for the Bears, but he's going to have enough for the first down, just almost like a dive play straight up the middle. Picks up three, and a first down for the Saints. Ball marked at the 23.
Give that running back real credit, too. Oh. Is that zero?
That's zero in there now. That is Anthony McAfee, the second out of Myrtle Beach and Coastal Carolina transfer.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, he hit that line, like you said, like the old-fashioned dive play. He was going full speed when he hit the line of scrimmage. He forced his way in there for the first down. That's excellent running.
They needed some time now on their offense. They've not done much. Play action pass, caught over the middle. Nice pass, slant play. And that play is picked up by Cedric Smith. The receiver gets enough for the first down, over the 30, up to the 34. And a second straight first down now for the Saints. Got something going, cooking here. Down 10-0, late stages of the first quarter.
I've been impressed with this young quarterback. That's quite an arm right there. He threw a very, very fine line drive throw right on target on that slant route. That's just an excellent play by the quarterback there and the receiver. Good route, good throw, good catch. Success.
He's in the shotgun. He bobbles the snap, and the running back falls on it. McAfee, who had the big run just a few moments ago, that time he just bobbled. The quarterback bobbled it, Beamish, and it went right almost into the hands of McAfee, and he just fell forward and fell on the football. It's going to be a loss of four on the play, back to the 30. Second down and long now for the Saints.
Again, that's being a freshman. Sometimes as a freshman, you're trying to do things before the ball gets to you. One thing about the shotgun, you have to wait for the ball to be snapped. You know, it may only take a split second to go that 4 or 5 yards, but you got to get it in your hands before you start maneuvering too much.
Three receivers out. This time they run it straight ahead. And the Bears had some pretty good defenses. They stood up that offensive line for Limestone. It's going to be a short yardage play, about maybe one. We'll be generous and give them a gain of two. It's going to be third and 12 now. Third and 12 for the Saints. Quickly, updates. South Atlantic Conference games. Wingate over Wise, 31-13, second half. Mars Hill leads Catawba 14-0 at home in the second quarter. Bowie State leading Virginia Union 17-7. Got a score from our buddy Jeff Jones. The Kansas is leading Oklahoma. That would be a monumental upset if that score stands, Jack. I think Kansas leading 17-14 in a game in the second half.
Yeah, that would be way up there. I mean, in terms of monumental upsets, I give Oklahoma a chance to come back in the fourth quarter and win that game. That would be something that would just be unheard of. But Oklahoma's kind of been that kind of team. They look great against the good teams, and then they just kind of flounder around against the teams that they ought to be beating quickly. They hadn't been able to do it. But, you know, the Bears off to another great start, and they're going to present the check out here, you know, for the homecoming, the tournament, and all the other things that go with it. Let's see how much it is. You'll have to look through the binoculars there. It looks like a big number.
$130,000, that's for the golf tournament alone, I believe.
We had 240 players out there yesterday. We had 120 in the morning, 100, first time in the history of the tournament. And I forgot how many years it is. It's a bunch, but it's the first time in the history that the tournament has been completely filled for the afternoon and the morning rounds. So fantastic. And all of you folks that came out and supported the Bears in that golf tournament, the activities last night that went on, we really appreciate all of you coming out and supporting Bear football. That's what makes it special. I heard somebody this morning, one of the young ladies, talking about what was so special to her when they had a great season. She said the community. And I was really taken back with that. She said the community support, the way things happened, things had to be done differently here. And the community and everybody just got behind that team. And that's what's happened with football over the last 10 years. People have gotten in a more supportive role, and it's branched out into our other sports as well.
Amber Holt Collier, who was an outstanding two sports star, was on a championship basketball team about a decade ago. She's the one talked about that. And here's a free play, a penalty call. Somebody jumped offside and a completed pass way down the field by Limestone. We'll see what the penalty is. Looks like it's going to go against the Bears, and a nice play. They kept the play going. He shot it down the field, and that was Smith on a nice catch over an LR defender way down in LR territory at the 33.
A classic example, the run, our defender was running step for step with the receiver, but never looked back and saw the ball. And the defender, the offensive player, was looking back and saw the ball clearly and just caught it. You can see, if we have the replay here, if you're watching at home, our defender just never looked for the ball. You have to find the football. Well, if you're a defensive back, you got to know where the ball is. We got a 15-yard penalty after the catch, too.
Oh, so that was maybe a roughing the quarterback call against the Bears.
Well, it was added on, yeah.
Yeah, it was a 3rd and 13, and they went deep and completed it, and now have it after the penalty down to the 18. And Beamish doing a good job, making his first start now, 4 of 8 through the air here the first half. Back to pass again, fires over here to the sidelines, knocked away and complete. Nice play by the Bear defense. Sedarius Kelly, the sophomore out of Greensboro, Georgia, with the hit that time, incomplete, 2nd and 10, stops the clock.
And that was just a flat drop. That ball should have been caught.
Yeah.
That was a good throw there. Yeah. The receiver was open. But two things showed on that last play that the Bears had difficulty. Number one, covering the pass. Number two, penalties. We've cut down on our penalties way, way down the last two games. But there's one that added on and poor coverage right there. Those two things cost us on that one play.
So the ball's at the 18, 2nd down and 10. Just underway, 2nd quarter. Bears lead 10-0. Beamish, the quarterback, and we have a timeout.
Limestone.
Timeout, Limestone. So let's take a timeout. We will step aside as well. It's 10-0 in favor of LR for homecoming this afternoon. Stay with us. You're listening to LR Football on WSVM.
Today.
Emergencies don't wait. Get to the hospital. Accidents happen. Get well soon. When it hurts to move forward, tackle your pain. Don't make your health wait. See your doctor. Your health means everything.
After the timeout, Limestone wanted to get things situated here. 2nd down. They're marching at the 18 of LR. Going to the open end here at Barrett Stadium. Quickly back to pass. Beamish, plenty of time. Throws it far corner end zone. Incomplete. Intended for receiver down to the corner of the end zone for Cody Jones, a redshirt freshman out of Greenville, South Carolina. And the Bears had excellent coverage, and that's going to force
King.
A 3rd down.
Percy King, and he's kind of a hybrid type guy. He can play outside, he can play inside. He was learning, running step for step with the receiver. And give the quarterback a little credit there. Beamish, he had to throw that ball out in front, and he did. He threw it far enough. Nobody was going to catch it unless his man could get to it. That was a heads-up play from a young freshman. 31-13 Wingate now in the third quarter. 31-13.
So it looks like Wingate is going to stay in first place. 3rd down here, 3rd and 10. They handed off to Patton. Very little play up there. Joseph coming in from his linebacker position, just kind of slices through there and makes the stop. Gain of maybe 1.
Looks like they're going to bring the kick. You know, it's unusual on either he just was sure he, if he didn't make it, he was going field goal all the way. Because usually if he run it on third down, you might be thinking about going for it on fourth, but he never hesitated to kicking teams out there.
J.B. Potts, who doubles as the punter and the kicker.
We talked about a potential fake. I don't know if we'll see it right here.
It's a block. It's what it is, and the Bears come up with a special teams play.
Wow,
I don't know if the kick got was too low, and I think Blanding.
That was number 23.
T.J. Blanding.
T.J. Blanding, the defender. He came around the outside. They were just slow getting it off. That's all it was. And if you're going to be slow getting it off and you allow a guy to come from the outside, that's on you.
Yeah, you're right. So the Bears special teams makes a play, and here comes the offense back out on the field. 10-0 in favor of the Bears. They moved the ball here this afternoon. They've just been stymied by they missed a field goal on another attempt, but they've been inside the red zone three times and have scored a touchdown only once. And here we go. First and 10. Bears have it right at the 20, midfield, right in the center of the football field. Grayson Willingham of the shotgun. McGee to his right hip. Three receivers. Tight end is Godwin. McGee. Check that. That's Willingham. He'll throw the pass. Caught over the 30. Good enough for the first down. Wrestled out of bounds. Again, Parsons. Kellen Parsons, a freshman out of King. One of those 84 freshmen. I thought that was just remarkable. We never had 84 guys on the football team for years and years. They got 84 on the team as freshmen.
That's right, and that's 2 years worth of freshmen.
Yeah.
Remember that, though. That's one thing that does make a difference.
First down, Bears over the 30. Here's a handoff. McGee, he is wrapped up, knocked down at about the 32. So that's a pickup of maybe two on the play. Second down and 8 now for the Bears.
Yeah, the Bears look like they might get a little out of that. And McGee, as soon as he started to cut, somebody grabbed his leg and never let go. He runs out of more tackles, too, for a little guy. And when I mean that, I'm saying he runs out of tackles where people look like they got him and they just can't get their arms around him and bring him down.
Offensive line has improved as well the last few weeks, keeping guys off of McGee. Here is a little reverse. No running room for Parsons. I call it a reverse. That's almost like a shovel pass.
It's really a way to run the jet sweep, but it is passing yardage.
Yes.
That goes down as a minus pass because I don't know what we wound up losing, a yard or so. About 2 yards we lost on that. But he tosses the ball, and that's the guy kind of run into it instead of handing it to him. You know, the jet sweep, it usually comes from the quarterback under center, and he turns around and hands it to him.
Yeah.
This, he's in the shotgun, and he just tosses it to him. And the Bears have tried it a couple times and to no success.
Bears will send four receivers out. Willingham back to pass, throwing it down the field. Caught, making a nice reception. Outstretched arms. Great play, Ryan Carter, first down across the 50.
There's a defensive back. I haven't gotten his number yet, but he is going to be really upset when he watches the video. He had a chance to pick that ball, and he went behind instead of in front. And here comes the replay. See the defender? He went right behind him instead of going in front. He goes in front, he picks that ball off. Great throw and catch. Ryan Carter has turned into our best, I think, receiver.
And here's another pass to Carter. He catches it at the 40, tries to jump over the defensive back. The DB, Jeremiah Bogan, just upended Ryan Carter, but he picked up about 5 on the play after a 25-yard pickup on the previous play. So Willingham and Carter, a couple of veteran players for the Bears, hooking up on back-to-back plays. The Bears have it now deep in Limestone territory at about the 35.
I think Carter has become our most explosive player outside of Dwayne McGee. He's the guy that can make and break a big play for you.
Sounds the Bears have two tight ends set. They'll delay handoff to McGee up the middle, and he tries to spin his way down to the 32. That's shy of the first down, so that's going to be about a 5-yard pickup nonetheless. Going to bring up third and short now for the Bears. 10 minutes and 50 seconds to go before the half. Bears on top here, 10-0 on a beautiful sun-splashed afternoon here at the 80th homecoming in LR history.
The greatest thing about having running back like McGee and Davis and even number 25, Jacoby Lane, when he's in there is – you know, they can make you look a little better. They have the quickness and the speed to break big plays, but they can make that real quick burst right there and get a couple of yards when it doesn't look like they'll get anything.
Game of first down, so first and 10. Willingham scrambling with the ball, and he tries to jump over a defender, picks up the first down at about the 20. I don't know if you want to see your star quarterback trying to leap tall buildings in a single bound.
I tell you what you want to see, though. It's 11 or 10 other guys run over there to pick him up.
Yeah.
That's what they think of Grayson Willingham. When he ran that football there, and that was a crucial play. The Bears needed to keep this drive alive after, the success that Limestone had last drive. We want to give that defense a little break, and we needed that play, and Grayson made it for us.
A first down run. This time McGee cutting back at the 20, at the 15, getting some good blocks down the field. He'll get it inside the 10. Should be enough for another first down. Goes Dwayne McGee down to the 9. So the Bears this time marching to the closed end here at Moret Stadium in front of the John David Moose Field sign. And a good crowd down there. Jack, the band, I noticed this morning that they said this is the 80th year that there has been a band on the campus of LR.
And I'll tell you what, that band and our all the things that we have, the dance team, the cheerleaders, they add so much to these contests. It's unbelievable. And Neil Underwood, just fantastic what he's done with that band.
First and goal, and the Bears are going to call a timeout after the run by McGee. First and 10, and we'll take a quick timeout ourselves. 10-0 in favor of the Bears, back in a jiffy. This is LR Football on 96.5 WSVM.
Citizens.com. Because so much depends on what.
Juju Phillips, Jack Huss. Bears have it first and goal. Quick pass over here. Caught by Parsons. He'll get it inside the 8. They're supposed to give 60 seconds on a timeout, right, Jack?
Well, sometimes.
Sometimes. Anyway, the Bears get 4 on the play, second down and goal now. Ball's on the far left hash. Again, what a great afternoon for a homecoming. One of the bigger crowds that we've seen for a homecoming here.
Oh, yeah, this is huge. This our side is completely packed all the way across the end zone.
Second down and goal. McGee with the handoff.
Unbelievable.
He's going to break a tackle.
Unbelievable.
And get into the land of milk and honey.
Wow.
Dwayne McGee, his 7th touchdown in the last game and a half.
Those of you that are watching the stream, watch for this replay when Danny gets it ready. I'm going to tell you what, this is as good a run as you'll ever see for 5 yards. He's hit, he's down, 3 guys around him. He jukes them, beats the last guy in the end zone. What a run. He just has a knack. I mean, this is an innate ability to see and do. Coach Painter used to always say, we recruit players that can see and do. Yeah. You know, that kid can see and do.
So can the kicker that time, Chase Elbaugh. He has done amazing. He has set an NCAA Division II record with consecutive extra points. He tacks on another. 8:42 to go before the half. Bears on the board again. It's LR 17 and Limestone nothing. You're listening to LR Football here on WSVM.
Center Street.
Back here, Juju Phillips along with Jack Huss. 17-0 in favor of the Bears as they are on top of the Saints of Limestone in seventh meeting between these two in school history. Thank you, David. Thank you very much.
Our halftime guest, David O. Stevens.
Author and friend,
Exponential Great.
I need to pay for this, my friend. I am going to do that. Okay.
David Stevens just came into the press box and brought Juju his copy of the book, but we wanted to get copies of it. I got mine this morning, and David and Juju said, I got to get one, and I contacted David, and he brought one up and just handed it to Juju. And Juju said, now I'm going to pay you for it. And David said, I put it on my credit card.
So I'll make the donation then to the
– we're all making the donation.
Absolutely.
All of us, even the author. He donated 200 copies of this book. So we're excited about that.
First authorized version of the history of Lenoir Rhyne football. Labor of love, I'm sure, David. And we're going to hear more from David coming up at halftime. All Bears here in the first half. Still got 8.5 minutes to go before the half. It's 17-0. Here's a kick in the end zone that's bobbled around, and they'll take a knee, and they'll get it at about the 25-yard line. So the Bears, offensively, they move the ball, have not stopped. Been able to be stopped, Jack, except maybe, you know, early on they moved the ball inside the red zone and didn't come away with touchdowns, didn't come away with points every time, but the offense is certainly clicking here in the first half against a team that has struggled. And if you're going to take on a team that's maybe looking for that first win, you want to put them down and put them down early, and the Bears have done that so far.
Exactly, and if had Limestone been able to get 7 points or even 3 points on that last drive, I think it might have inspired them a little bit, because they've had some good chance opportunities. They just couldn't get it in the end zone or get the extra point. I mean, the field goal made on the last one. So that's kind of changed things. But, you know, the Bears have 14 first downs already. We talked about 40. I mean, with 8 minutes to go, we could wind up with we might wind up with 20 first downs in the first half if we come out and have a good series.
So this time Limestone's backed up. I guess a penalty back at the –
yeah, there was a penalty back here for something.
13-yard line, quick pass over here. It is caught where the Bears wrestle the receiver over the 15 up to the 17. Wrestled out of bounds by T.J. Blanding on the stop. So gain of about 4. Second and 6 now for Limestone. Their quarterback is Ethan Beamish out of Simpsonville, South Carolina, true freshman. He was a third-team quarterback, Jack, but – considering the circumstances, making his first collegiate start, he's looked pretty good.
He's looked excellent to me. They've got him in some situation. I would think he looks like a kid that could run. I would be surprised if they wouldn't try to get him outside a little more.
Here's a veteran running back is Patton, and he is hit at the middle. Now that's another backup running back. This time it's 28, Trey Stewart out of Winston-Salem, and Winston-Salem Prep High School. He's hit by the Bear front line and just got knocked backwards, gain of 2, third down and 4.
They gave him progress down for a couple of yards there. He got hit and went backwards, but gave him forward progress for a couple of yard gain.
Did the Bears bring pressure here? Limestone trailing 17.
They have been bringing pressure.
Yeah.
They did it last week, even against Carson Newman. Let's see if those two linebackers don't take off up in there.
Trips on the far side. Beamish looks that way. Throws it across the middle.
Got it.
Intercepted. Flag down.
Oh, no. They're going to call interference.
Ball was tipped by one of the Bear linebackers. Dante Young came up with the interception. See what the flag's about here.
They're either going to call holding or interference on the Bears. I am afraid. I may be wrong, but I am afraid they're going to call it. It's either holding or interference, one of the two. Let's see which way they go. Yeah, I couldn't tell. It looked so close. And when I saw the flag fly, I knew what it was. Yeah, it was really, really close.
Percy King.
Yeah, it was
flag.
Number 17.
Yeah, sophomore.
And it was not, you know, it was one of those plays that just bang, bang. You know, when you're a defensive back, you're going for it. And on that slant, they'd had success on the slant. So that's their 6th first down. So the Bears have 14 and the Limestone 6 in the first down department.
Now the Bears will take those kind of penalties. You don't like to have them, but that's being aggressive and almost made a big play after the interception. Nullified that. Beamish back to pass. Under pressure, rolling right, looking downfield. Dumps it off for a receiver.
Did he catch it? Yeah.
I think he did. It'd be about a 5-yard pickup on the far side over there. And That's going to be second down to the 26, but a nice scrambling play by Beamish, the quarterback.
And the ball got tipped. That's what was interesting. The ball got tipped and kind of went up in the air, and the kid still made the catch and tapped his toe in bounds to stay in bounds. You know, that's the kind of play that I could see that freshman kid making. He just ran away from everybody. I was thinking about that kid from Catawba several years ago. He came up here with that freshman quarterback, and he just ran around all over the ballpark.
Had I don't think he had started, or they had some injuries, I remember. And they were having a fine season. The Bears had a chance maybe to get a win, and they did not do it. Here's another slant across the middle, incomplete. Hit and knocked away, incomplete. Pass intended over there for, I believe that was Hector. Bears had a nice hit by, I think, T.J. Blanding.
No, it was J.P. Palmer, I believe.
Okay, Palmer.
You know, but again, that was the throw was there. That's his worst throw of the day. He just threw the ball behind him.
Yeah.
You know, you got to put that ball in front and give him it. On a slant behind is always trouble. You got to always keep that ball out in front of him.
Third and six now. They'll send trips left here to the near side. Ball's on the far right hash. Bears show a little bit of pressure. Here they come. Dump pass tipped away at the line of scrimmage.
Incomplete.
And it's going to be incomplete. Incomplete, so good. Bears got good pressure up the middle. Somebody, the defensive lineman, got a hand on the football, and it went incomplete, so it's going to bring up a punting situation now for Limestone.
And one of the things you want to do, and I see Coach Turk over there, he pulled his quarterback talking to him. You want to be sure of with a freshman quarterback is don't put him in a situation where he has to make too many decisions, okay? Give him a place to throw the ball, and he did the right thing. And I think Coach Turk was just telling him, say, hey, son, not your fault. The ball got tipped. You did what you were supposed to do.
Here's the punt. The Bears almost block it.
Nope.
Punt that is field, fair catch. I said play action. Fair catch at the 39.
I tell you what, that was excellent right there for the – they got away. I thought they might get a running into the kicker back there, but they didn't. And Coach Turk is questioning with the white hat out there why he didn't call that. It could have been running into the kicker, which is a 5-yard penalty and not a first down.
So the Bears get really decent field position at the 39.
Yeah, time not a factor either as far as, you know, going into any kind of two-minute offense. And, you know, put seven more on the board right here would make the Bears feel a little more at ease in this game going into the second half.
Bears on top. Turn, handed off. McGee has a hole right side over the 50. Springing through there before he is tackled at the ankles at the 45 of Limestone.
Good job.
A nice pickup of about 20 yards by McGee into Limestone territory.
Cody Osborne over there, Ian Brentson over there, number 51, one of the big guys that blocks on that left side. I was just looking at the Bears' offensive lineup that's starting today, Juju, and we were talking about it. Freshman, sophomore, grad student. So Ian Brentson is the only one now. We're down to, starting sophomores and freshmen outside of Ian Brentson at right tackle. And Ian's been around forever. He's played a lot of football. He and Grayson Willingham played a lot of football games for the Bears.
Isaac Chapman, right guard. He's been out for some injury. He's back in there. They run right behind him. McGee does, and he finds a hole again inside the 35, now to about the 32. And that'll be another run and a first down for the Bear running back. As the Bears are marching again, so they're going off right side behind Isaac Chapman out of Alexander Central High in Taylorsville, North Carolina. And he gets back-to-back first down runs for LR.
And that secondary has done a marvelous job of tackling. They've had to make a lot of them, but they've done a marvelous job of tackling because Dwayne McGee's had a couple plays where he almost broke it, and somebody from the secondary came from the backside to get him.
Bears are getting a good initial surge to get McGee into the secondary. This time they hand it to him again, Jack, and he picks up five. Looked like they had him right, stopped at the line of scrimmage, but because that offensive line is pushing forward and they get five, maybe six on the play for McGee, who's, you said, over 100 yards here in the first half already.
Yeah, McGee should be, he should be over 100 with ease. Let's see what we got here. He is at 13 carries, 126 yards.
Here's Willingham.
Get rid of it.
And
get
he's
going
to keep it. Run
out
of bounds.
There you go.
First down inside, close to the first down at the 24-yard line.
And the Bears' offensive line, Juju, we talked about, is still light compared to a lot. 305 for Brinson, 275 for Wells, 270 for Jefferson, the center, 320 for Franz, and 275, two freshmen at left tackle and left guard.
All right, so third down now for the Bears. Third and about a long three.
We got the wind behind us, so a field goal here is not out of the question if we don't make it.
So McGee over 100 yards for the seventh consecutive game. This time it's Davis has a hold to the 15. Down to the 10. Scoots his way into the end zone. Jadis Davis, who had that extra gear. And he takes it into the land of milk and honey from 25 yards out. And the Bears are on the board again with 4 minutes to go in the first half. It's LR 23, Limestone nothing.
You know, it's funny. I had to look twice. I thought it was McGee. I didn't know that Davis had taken his place because they looked like the same run. Looked like the same two backs right there. That's just a great run by Jadis Davis. And down there about the 10-yard line, he had one defensive player to beat, and he just gave him the in-out move. Boom, ran into the end zone untouched. I don't think anybody laid a hand on him. If that had been two-hand tag, he would have scored.
Extra point. Hits the Kyle Duggar side back there on top of the Schuffer Gymnasium. 24-0 in favor of the Bears. We'll be back with more. LR dominating this game here at homecoming. Schuffer Gymnasium and Moret Stadium packed here this afternoon. Stay with us. Back with more after this. This is LR Football.
Celebrate great with Carolina West Wireless. Great new phones and a great customer experience all on our great nationwide high-speed network. Stop by today and get big savings on select Samsung smartphones, like $350 off the Samsung Galaxy S20 and S20 Plus, and $350 off the Note 20 and Note 20 Ultra. The great savings continue with 4 lines of unlimited data for just $35 a month per line. Celebrate great savings and go stay connected wherever your travels take you.
Stadium, homecoming, LR dominating this football game. Late stages, first half, 24-0 in favor of LR. Here's the kickoff, and Limestone has it, running with the ball, getting over the 20, spun down at about the 22. Again, some fine spirited play on the kickoff team by Jacquez Dew, and he has been second or third time here today as he has come away with the tackle as the Wasp and Hornets have invaded here in the Red Stadium press box.
The Bears have 17 first downs in the first half, 6 for Limestone. 184 yards rushing for the Bears, 5 for Limestone. The Bears have 119 yards passing, 74 for Limestone.
Thanks to our fantastic sponsors, again, part of the Bears Sports Network. Southeast Retirement Planners on a running play for Limestone, up to about the 25, gain of 2, 2nd and 8. Again, Oz Jewelers, your hometown jewelry store for over 38 years. Springs Road in Hickory, one of the fine sponsors of Bears football. And Custom Design Group, the official apparel provider of LR Athletics. Check them out online at lrwear.com. Custom Design Group, part of the network of fine sponsors and partners for Lenore Ryan Athletics. Second down and 8. Just about 3 minutes and 15 seconds to go before half. Here's a pass across the middle. It is caught for the first down. Nice play by the Bear defense over there. Percy King on the coverage. And not before, though. Limestone gets a first down to the 37.
They get to the line quickly to run the next play because they're almost in a two-minute drill situation. With 3 minutes to go, they're wanting to get down the field and get some points scored. I'll tell you in just a second when we get a chance about that slant pass.
Four receivers out, flag down, incomplete pass. Intending over there for the far side goes Ellison.
Got to be
a hold. The ball is too high.
Got to be a hold.
Yeah, either that or maybe an offside.
Yeah, from where the guy, the umpire calls it, it's usually not an offside because he's not looking down the line.
There is no foul. He's blocking all the way from the play.
There is no foul. Whatever it was, he decided it wasn't.
Yeah, original foul, blocking below the waist.
Okay. But I was telling you about the slant. The Bears do a lot of stunting now. And when you stunt your inside backers, that's what opens up the lane for that slant. That's why we've seen so many slant passes in the last few weeks, because we've stunted a lot. And that slant area is open when those linebackers are not dropping into those zones.
So the Bears tuning up for a possible showdown next week at Wingate. Wingate also doing the same, leading Wise 48-21 in their game this afternoon. Bears under, put some pressure on the quarterback, and what a nice play by the Bear defensive linebacker coming in from behind and making the stop is Josh Davis, a freshman out of Jacksonville, Florida, Fletcher High School, as a Beamish was scrambling to his right, as you can see, but right behind number 44, knocked him down with a nice tackle from behind, and that'll be a sack on the play, loss on the play, second down at about 15.
We got a penalty flag, but it looked like, again, it was picked up.
So yeah. Third down and 15.
Yeah. We picked up, that's two penalty flags that's been picked up the last two plays. I'm not even sure I thought that might have been a holding flag like the other one, but the referee threw that one, he picked it up.
Bears are substituting freely along that defensive line. They've had a couple of sacks already and numerous pressures. Low snap, back to pass. There's a dump pass across the middle, trying to make a move, but the Bears have three men around him and surround the wide receiver, Gary, and they knock him out of bounds, way shy of the first down. That'll bring out the punt unit for the Saints.
Excellent job by the officiating crew, too. Anytime three guys tackle a player from the opposing team and it goes into the home team's bench like that, you want to get over there and make sure there's no hanky-panky going on. And they did a great job. That's a good job by the officiating crew paying attention.
So here comes the punt now for Limestone. It's going to be Austin Kemp, redshirt junior out of Liberty, South Carolina.
Bears should have reasonable field position and can go to the two-minute drill.
Bring a little pressure.
Went off side of his foot. Let's see what happens. Now they're going to get a good bounce.
Yeah. Bear return man, Ted just running away from the football, and it's going to be down at the 30. Down at the 30. Still plenty of time. 90 seconds to go before the half. Actually, 89 seconds to be official, but I wasn't a math guy in college or in high school. But Bears still have some time, Jack, to get on the board leading here 24-0.
Yeah, no question. You can do a two-minute drill right here. This is good work, good practice right here for the Bears. Wayne McGee, 13 rushes, 126 yards, and two touchdowns. Ryan Carter, three receptions, 49 yards. DeAndre Lester, two receptions, 42 yards. And Willingham is completed 10 of 14 for 119 yards with a long of 36.
Back to pass. Grayson looking downfield.
There you go.
Caught.
There you go.
First down, 48, just crossing the field in front of Grayson as he bought some time. And I believe that it, yeah, you're right. First down will say zero, but I know they had. That's Jordan Payne on the reception out of Vance High School in Charlotte for the first down to the 49 near midfield. I got the pass over here to Payne. Hauls it in. First down. Makes a move. And he'll get the first down inside the 40 to the 39 of Limestone. Stops the clock with 108 to go before the half.
Two excellent throws by Willingham. One on a scramble. The other one was just a quick out route, and he let the ball go before Payne ever turned, and the ball was right on the money.
Another pass. Flag down. Pass is caught by Lester.
Two flags down. There's one down over here on the boundary, and there's one right there where the holding call comes. Now, let's see if he'll pick this one up for us. He picked two up for, you know, they ought to be nice to pick one up for us. I don't know what the boundary flag over here could be, that somebody was offsides. I'm not sure. Let's see. It could be offsetting penalties, too. Ineligible downfield.
Number 23 on the offense.
Yeah, we lined up improperly. Now, what the flag is in the middle, I don't know. What the umpire. But the boundary flag was because we lined up improperly, and when you line up, one guy on that, if you got two receivers, one of them has to be off the line of scrimmage,
yeah,
and obviously both of them were on the line of scrimmage. That makes the inside guy ineligible. That's almost a joke in football today. I don't even know why that matters.
There are a handful of rules in football that they need to go through and throw away.
Arcane.
Yeah, arcane and archaic. One or the
both
other.
Both of them.
First and long now. Willingham under pressure gets hit from behind. They call it incomplete. Ball jumped forward, but that time Grayson didn't see him coming off the edge to his blind side. He stepped up in the pocket as he was delivering it. Hit from behind. Falls incomplete. Second down and 15.
If you look on the replay here, there's no receiver open, and he just took a long time to. And finally, he decided what he was going to do with the ball. And the defender came from far on the outside on his backside, and he had turned away, so he's the guy's coming at him from behind, so he's got no chance to see that guy to do anything about it.
I think the Bears are going to send four out, and here comes Limestone on the pressure. Man-to-man coverage, throws it over here.
Great job.
Caught. Lester.
Notice the timing on the last throw. That ball was in the air before Lester. And that's something Grayson hasn't been great at, the drop back pass and put the ball in the air before the receiver makes the break. That's two of them he's done on this series. They're just great.
Bears needed 15. He got about 12. Third and short now for LR.
And the clock is still not that much of a factor. The Bears should have at least two. They do two timeouts left.
Third down in the long three. 32-yard line.
Five wide.
Willingham across the middle, through the hands, incomplete. Incomplete intended over there for Carter. Had a chance, but it went right through his hands, so that's going to see the Bears go for it here on fourth down. Why not, right? 38 seconds left, leading by 24.
We got the win for a field goal if we wanted to try it. There was and he may call a timeout here and think it over. I don't know. Looks like we're slow getting the mail. He finally got the play in there, but you know, Grayson, there was a mistake up front. They didn't rush but four, and one of them came clean on a little crossing move inside and got to Grayson before he had time to get it off.
Quick pass over here, over the head.
No
incomplete, intended for Lester. That play didn't look good from the outset as Willingham threw it high for Lester, and he barely came out of his break. So it's going to be a change of downs here. Ball turned over on downs. Limestone will get it with 34 seconds left, but the Bears have been mighty sharp here for the most part, Jack, in the first half. 24-0 in favor of LR 34 seconds ago.
Exactly. The Bears, the only thing that is a little bit concerning is that's the third time the Bears have moved the ball down there and then had a bad series. We had an entire bad series of plays right there when we didn't do much, and we had that early in the game.
Beamish rolling left under pressure and goes down. Oh, what pressure came from all sides. Joseph blitzing up the middle.
And Amari Houston.
Yeah.
Probably Joseph should get credit for the sack, and Houston a tackle for a loss maybe.
I mean, Ethan Beamish hadn't have a chance.
And he should have got rid of the ball. That's a freshman mistake. Watch how long he's got. See, now you got to get rid of it. Get rid of it. See, it's too late.
Yeah.
You know.
You got to have that inner clock.
Yeah, you got to understand that thing. That play is done. You know, there's nothing else can happen good there.
That's going to be it for the first half. First half is in the books. Homecoming 2021. And it's all LR, your score. As we go to the break, it's LR 24, Limestone nothing. Hey, stay with us. We'll come back with some special halftime activities for Homecoming, Hall of Fame, and the first ever authorized book noting the history of Lenoir Rhyne football, the 100-year history of LR football. That is up next. Stay with us as our halftime continues as we roll on. This is Bear Sports on the LR Sports Network, being brought to you by MBA Roofing and on WS.
This once-in-a-generation project will give student-athletes an advantage and position Lenore Ryan as a leader in academics and athletics.
There was an opportunity to have my college paid for if I was good enough to play baseball at that level. That was going to make a big difference in my family. D2 baseball gave me an opportunity to play at a high level and to get an education that's going to be valuable for me throughout the rest of my life. I chose to take my experience of being a student athlete and pursue that within my career and to get a master's degree. If I wouldn't have had a baseball scholarship, there'd be no chance that I'm doing what I'm doing today.
Emergencies don't wait. Get to the hospital. Accidents happen. Get well soon. When it hurts to move forward, tackle your pain. Don't make your health wait. See your doctor. Your health means everything.
In NCAA Division II, community engagement is an initiative at all 25 national championships because student-athletes want to give back while competing for a national title. Over the course of the year, Division II student-athletes have an opportunity to leave a lasting impression in local communities throughout the country. Whether Division II student-athletes are volunteering at hospitals, schools, after-school care programs, foster homes, or retirement villages, they make a difference in the lives of others. In Division II, we rise to the opportunity and make community engagement ours.
Doesn't matter who you are, Everett has you covered. Proud sponsor of the LR Bears.
If you play hard, if you use your feet to chase fitness goals, if you stand all day at work, introducing True Energy Infrared Technology Socks. These may be the best socks you ever wear. Our yarn is infused with infrared nanoparticles. Your body's natural heat ignites these tiny particles, producing infrared energy that improves circulation and stimulates cellular recovery. It's not magic, it's rocket science. The perfect sock for your active life, for fitness, performance, recovery. Proven innovation to ignite your true energy.
Being a champion takes more than talent, more than the perfect pass, more than using your head. Being a champion takes the spirit to always push harder, the ability to overcome any hurdle, and the fire to be the best. Welcome to Division II, where the pursuit is yours to create. And the question isn't, can you do it? It's, will you?
Celebrate great with Carolina West Wireless. Great new phones and a great customer experience all on our great nationwide high-speed network. Stop by today and get big savings on select Samsung smartphones, like $350 off the Samsung Galaxy S20 and S20 Plus, and $350 off the Note 20 and Note 20 Ultra. The great savings continue with four lines of unlimited data for just $35 a month per line. Celebrate great savings and go stay connected wherever your travels take you.
Paramount Kia in Hickory. We want to see you driving a new Kia or, hey, a quality pre-owned Kia. We've got a huge selection of new and pre-owned Kias. You got to get to Paramount Kia in Hickory, Highway 70, ParamountKia.com.
Being a champion takes more than skill, more than endless drills, more than using your head. Being a champion takes the heart to give it your all, the agility to thrive from any angle, and the relentless drive to be the best. Welcome to Division 2, where the pursuit is yours to create. And the question isn't, can you do it? It's, will you?
Big thank you, of course, to David Stevens. Great interview, man. That was really, it's a almost as if, Jack, that was a story within the story of the book. You guys really touched on all aspects of the history of LR football.
Well, the good thing, you know, you got to get the book to get the information. But what David, I cannot tell you how impressed I was when I first got involved with helping out and finding stuff and telling him who to go to, like Ben Bundy, for instance, and, you know, other people like that that were out there that had information and pictures. But I tell you, what he did prior to that and what he did in terms of research, you got to devote your almost full attention to doing it, and he did it. And that's a very, very special book.
The first authorized coffee table book on the history, 100-year history, of LR football out today. We'll tell you more as we continue our broadcast. You can pick it up, I believe, beginning next week, Jack. We'll be releasing, I guess, the online address where fans can pick that up as well.
Yeah, the online. And David did say this, that I didn't realize they do have plenty of books. So they'll be out there and available for you next week online. Look for it. LRBears.com.
Gotcha. 24-0 here in favor of the Bears as we start the second half for the 80th homecoming afternoon here between the bricks as the Bears kick it off, and they'll play defense to start the second half. Limestone comes out on offense in that first half, 7 first downs and under 100 yards of total offense for the Saints, trailing 24-0. Quarterback is Beamish. He'll hand it off. Bears strip
ball loose.
Ball loose. Waiting on the call, I believe, maybe Limestone able to maintain possession, but it's going to be a loss on the play of 5. Second down and 14 now, or 15 for the Saints.
We barrel through halftime without the stats. Dwayne McGee, 13 carries, 126 yards. Willingham, 13 of 20 for 162. That's pretty much the ball game, ladies and gentlemen.
It is. Second down and 14. Beamish back to pass, rolls right, throws. Complete fumble. Is it a fumble?
They're calling it a fumble.
And it's a touchdown.
Yeah, the guy that's right on top of it, he's calling touchdown. That's a Bear touchdown right there.
Yes, indeed. Preston Joseph picked up the loose football as he picked it up off the ground, pilfered it off the ground, and he takes it into the end zone on the second play of the second half. Touchdown. Preston Joseph scores, and the Bears go out on top 30-0 with 14:15 to go here in the third quarter.
I don't know if there's a – I believe, isn't there a statistic for a forced fumble? Number 17, yeah. Percy King, is the one that forced that fumble. He hit the receiver, and it looked like he'd taken a step or two, but sometimes they'll just call that incomplete. But he looked like to me he'd run a step or two when Percy King hit him and the ball came loose. Preston Joseph gets the touchdown.
Good defensive play as the unit scores a touchdown for the Bears. Had a couple of those in the spring. I believe one or two against Wingate, and I believe it was Joseph who scored that touchdown and against Wingate earlier this year in the spring season. Extra point tacked on by the Bears, by Albots, now 31-0 as we just start the second half of action. The Bears haven't played offense. They've had 2 plays in the second half on defense. The Bears get a defensive touchdown. LR on top, 31-0, back with more. You're listening to Bear Sports on the LR Sports Network, presented by MBA Roofing and on WSVM Radio.
At People's Bank.
Here. I sure could use a tier one.
This is just cherry like cheer wine.
You can drink the
cheer wine and diet.
After the kickoff, and this Bear scored the touchdown. Limestone returns it. Gets pretty good field position, actually. It was a line drive kick and over the 35 up to the 36. So the Bears will play defense again here in the second half. 31-0 in favor of LR. Jack didn't have a chance. You mentioned a couple of highlights on the stats. What else jumps out at you for the Bears in that first half?
Well, the Bears, it was pretty much domination. The Bears did what they had to do. They gave up a little bit of yardage, but not much. They only gave up 78 yards of total offense if you count in the minus statistics that Limestone had. And the Bears have just like this play right here. The running back didn't even get back to the line of scrimmage before he got back hit, and he was running straight ahead. The Bears just dominated. Now, there is a penalty flag. Let's see what it is. Maybe the Bears got offside. Maybe that's how we were able to get back there so quick. But, there, statistically speaking, there's nothing there that you wouldn't expect with a 24-0 or a 31-0 score now after picking up the one, because offensive stats didn't change it. So the Bears declined the penalty. It was against Limestone for – they aligned improperly, whatever that case may be.
Andre Jefferson made the stop, the defensive end, number 32, the true freshman out of Illinois. So loss of two on the play, second and 12. Back to pass is the quarterback, Beamish, down the field, incomplete, trying to go across the field. Ball was intended for his top receiver over there, but I think the Bears had pretty good coverage, Jack, Ellison was the receiver in the area, and the Bears had pretty tight coverage.
And they don't look to have the core of receivers like we have seen on a few of the teams that we've played earlier. They're getting some people open, but they're not – and they've had a couple of drops. They're just not getting their hands on the ball. Quick update, Mars Hill in the fourth quarter leads Catawba 31-14 in the fourth quarter. And we had Bowie State up there. Bowie State 20, Virginia Union 7.
There's a third down long pass deep down the field. Receiver tried to come back and almost came up with the catch. A circus catch with Jackson on the coverage for the Bears. Incomplete. And that'll force a punt. You said Bowie State on top of Virginia Union.
Bowie State, Virginia Union. It's 20-7, Bowie.
Okay, so Bowie State, top team out of the CIAA, which is a conference of note in this particular region in Division II football. Hey, Mars Hill, quietly having a pretty good season. They're only a game off the pace, Jack, in terms of the South Atlantic Conference. Their only loss, I believe, coming at the hands of the Bears.
Yeah, and Wingate polished off Wise, 48-21.
Final score.
The thing about thing that happened, there's interference on the kick catch. We had a guy, that's Ryan Carter, trying to catch the ball, and the guy ran into him. No, it wasn't Ryan. Yeah, it was Ryan Carter trying to catch the ball. One of the defenders ran into him as he was catching the ball, so the Bears are going to get a penalty right there. But, what's happened to Wise now? By beating us, nobody takes them quite as lightly. So they've gone into play now, and people have been ready for them. They said, hey, we know they're capable. Look what they did to Lenore Ryan. So, that's kind of set the stage for them. It hurt us, obviously, but it also hurt them in the fact that now nobody's looking past them.
The flag's going to go against Limestone. I believe that was Sturdivant, who freshman running back, was back to return that punt, Jack, and not Mitchell for LR.
And so, I thought it was Carter.
Carter. And it's going to be a penalty against the Saints. They're going to move it up near midfield to the 45. Yeah, that normally it's Ryan Carter, but I think that was Daquan Sturdivant, the freshman out of Anson County.
Shawan 28-18 over Elizabeth City. I don't know if you got that one up there, but, that's in the third quarter. And Notre Dame 27-7 over Glenville State.
There's a running play.
Good gracious, look at that.
Yep,
look
McGee,
that.
Still running.
Unbelievable.
I mean, you can't get him down. His quick feet. He was running left, spun, and made good yardage. It is going to be a gain of 9.
His yards after contact.
Yeah, amazing.
They got to be some kind of – if they would keep a stat on that, go back and look at all the video. Yards after the initial first hit. His yards after – if he's got 1,000 yards, he's had 600 after contact. I'm telling you what, he just makes plays with his legs.
Gain of 9.
Tusculum, 27-17 over Barton.
Play action. Willingham going deep down the field as he tries to go, but excellent coverage. intended over there for Payne, Jordan Payne, but he was running side by side with a great defensive back for Limestone, and it falls incomplete. Third down and one.
It's unique. The official ran along the side of Payne all the way back up to the field who had made that call. And I don't know if there was some handsy play involved there, but he didn't call anything. But he kind of gave Payne a little, information on what went on there.
Here's a running play. And on third and one,
look at that.
McGee still going. He had the first down easily, and the pile starting to move ahead.
The all the scrum.
Way. Yeah.
The scrum.
All the way down to the 32. And that's going to be a pickup of about 18 yards for McGee and a first down.
You know, I don't know if it's a stat that, but I believe we were talking about last week that he's got a minimum of 160 yards of every game he's played at Lenoir Ryan except for one since he started playing back in the spring. And he's going to get real close to it pretty quick.
This time, though, wow. He gets hit in the backfield,
look
spun
that.
Out, nearly broke a tackle.
He has a three-yard loss, and he almost got away from him.
He came in at halftime at 126. He's probably up close to 150 in a loss on that play. So loss of four, second down and 14. Again, we'll run some scores for you. In the Division II ranks, Wingate defeated Wise 48-21. Bears go to Wingate next week in a big showdown in the South Atlantic Conference. Also in the sack today, Mars Hill over Catawba, 31-14. And those games going on. Barton playing at Tusculum. That game
got 27-17 in third quarter.
Tusculum?
Tusculum. 27-17 third quarter.
And tonight, or actually later this afternoon, probably just underway, Carson Newman at Newberry.
Yeah, I saw that score a while ago. I don't think there's a score posted on it. Yeah, Carson Newman, and it's got listed as a 4 o'clock start.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they haven't started yet.
Most of the teams in the Gulf South Conference play later this afternoon or tonight. West Florida, which got knocked off, number one team of the country last week, they are at home against Shorter. And North Greenville goes to West Georgia. That game coming up tonight at 6 o'clock.
And all those losses in that Gulf South helped the Bears in one respect. At least knocks out some undefeated teams out of the Gulf South. As long as they were undefeated, you knew they were going to get in the playoffs.
Yeah. Grayson Willingham will try to throw the pass high, intended over there for Carter, but it was just way over his head, incomplete.
That was one that required just a little bit of air just to drop it in there. That was a little bit – he threw a pretty good little bullet right there. That needed a little bit of air under it just to drop it in there. Carter was in between and had a pretty good chance to break that the rest of the way, but it had to be just – that was just a tough throw.
Grayson coming off a performance last week against Carson Newman, a career high, 359 through the air. And today he was over 50%, close to 200 yards passing. Back to pass again, down the middle, complete. Parsons spins through, down to the 10, first down Bears, right down to the middle of the field as the Bears get the nice pass and run by Parsons.
In 1965, when I came to Lenoir Ryan, that's the first pass play I ever saw. It was called 45. The tight end ran down the field, and the wingback went down and came underneath. That's exactly what they did. Ryan Carter went down up the field, and Parsons came underneath right behind him, and he was wide open. That play's been around forever, and it still works. Sometimes things just are good in football.
Twins left, ball in the right hash. They throw it over here to the near side. Again, spinning his way. Nice run by Lester.
Touchdown.
And a touchdown. Lester, just a little screen pass to the receiver. He made a move, broke a tackle, and he gets into the end zone. And the Bears are on the board again thanks to another touchdown pass from Willingham to Lester. Bears lead it now 37-0.
You know, that was a spectacular play, but one of the things that made that play work, if you watch right here, he made that – just that guy ducked his head. When you try to tackle, if you duck your head, you're going to miss the guy.
Yeah.
He ducked his head, and he grasped out, and Lester made that little move and went right around him for the touchdown.
Can't tackle somebody with your head now, and you don't know what you're – like you said, grasping for air. The Bears – tack on the extra point. It's 38-0. Bears have scored twice here in the first 5 minutes, or 4 minutes, actually, of the second half. Back with more. Stay with us. This is LR Football on WSVM Radio.
Quality work that's...
Pass for Grayson Willingham. He adds to his record total of touchdown passes in his career. And I thought it was interesting that Coach Jacobs told me this week about the support that Grayson Willingham has had. He said he made his first phone call when he got the job at LR. He made it to Willingham, and Grayson has been unwavering in his commitment to his teammates and the program. And he cannot be thankful enough for what he has done in you know, promising to stay. You know, had a chance to move on, Jack, start with his life's work, put his career on hold to come back and play and lead this football program for another year. And he continues to show why he is maybe marching in the future 10 years from now as being a LR Sports Hall of Famer.
Oh, there's no question about it. He's made the path right there in front of him. And, you know, like I said earlier, a young fellow that's willing to work and devote the time, and he sets the example for the rest of the team because they know he's successful.
Trying to make this a special season. Here's a kickoff return by Limestone, weaving his way over the 20 before he's pushed out at about the 23. So that is where the Saints will start this drive, trailing 38-0, as the Bears are going to substitute freely here in the second half. Though some starters remain on defense. Dan Luba's in there, but number 93, DeAndre Shelton, I think got the start today. And Andre Jefferson on defensive ends for Quentin Hayes. Also, Amari Houston's played quite a bit. I don't think he's in there right now, Jack, but the Bears have shown a lot of depth, especially on the defensive line, all year.
Yeah, they played a number of players. Let's see what's going on. Official ran all the way from there to get back to the official here, and they're going to reset something. But anyway, the Bears have substituted liberally in most of the games with the defensive linemen. I thought up at Virginia Wise we played our starters a lot more than usual. Of course, we were struggling in the game, but I thought we played them a lot more than usual. And, you know, these guys, Luba particularly in Houston inside, are just stalwarts. And we've seen some other guys that have really come on this year. I've been very, very impressed. And earlier in the game, had an interception, I think, of Dante Young at linebacker. He's seen a lot of play in there. Like Preston Joseph is getting a break right now. Dante Young's in there, and John Ross May's in there. So they got three linebackers they can play inside. John Ross is not a big guy. He's 6 feet, 210 pounds. And Dante Young is 6 feet, 230 pounds, a little bigger. Preston Joseph is probably the smallest, but, yeah, he's 6 feet, 210. You know, so they got some guys that are interchangeable in that position.
Cam Jordan, another freshman defensive lineman out of Greenwood, South Carolina, in there. Slant pass across the middle. It's caught, running with the ball in the space at the 50, at the 40, and is drugged down from behind about the 34-yard line. Nice big play by Limestone, Jack, on the pass on the quick slant.
If there's been one play we've had great difficulty with, and Flick's coming off the field here with the
official,
one of the officials there, and that official, that the deep official that was deep in the middle of the field, is no longer there. They had to bring him in to cover the side. But you know, so there's no, you know, pass interference will be a different call now with nobody in the middle back there. But anyway, the slant pass is just there when you, you know, when your linebackers are coming up the field chasing passers, you know. Now that time we got it cut. See there? That's the difference. Dante Young, instead of stunning, came out to the flat to cover it, and that made the slant a tough throw, and he threw it behind him.
Yeah, and got tipped, and literally picked it off. And
if that ball's in front, Dante Young probably picks it.
The back-to-back slant passes. Cedric Smith, the intended receiver, caught the pass earlier that picked up good yardage over into LR territory. He's a graduate player out of Columbia, South Carolina. And, you know, you look at Limestone, they do have a lot of transfers, Jack, but a lot of these guys come through, they originally are from their natives of South Carolina. So second down and 10. Ball's at the LR 24. Quick pass over here. Play action incomplete. Incomplete in and out of the hands of the receiver. This time it is the tight end, Terrence Walker, out of Commerce, Georgia, redshirt sophomore. It wouldn't have been much of a pickup, but the ball fell incomplete and stops the clock. 10 minutes to go in the third quarter. Bears leading 38-0.
Think about it. Years ago, there was no Coastal Carolina. There was no Charleston Southern. There were not a lot of teams. As a matter of fact, Newberry Presbyterian and Wofford probably got the majority of the players out of South Carolina that were not going to South Carolina or Clemson. You know, and if you just think when the Carolina Conference existed and those teams were playing, man, they were getting some great players out of South Carolina.
Bears just cover up the quarterback, another sack.
Houston and Luba both got in there. They gave a half a sack to that one earlier. We were talking about where Joseph and Houston, I noticed on the stats they gave that as a half a sack to each one of them.
Maybe they ought to give him a quarter sack. Can you do that?
Probably. Let's see who they credit that one to. They'll pop up here on the stats in a second.
Yeah, I mean, Luba's in there. Houston is in there. Those guys, Jefferson. I mean, the entire front line just simply collapsed the offensive line for Limestone. So that's going to force a field goal as the Saints try to get on the board. Had one blocked earlier. This is going to be from 46 yards out. Ball's on the far left hash.
Could it be fake time?
Low snap. Kick is high enough, long enough.
Good.
And good. So the Saints get on the board with 9:08 to go here in the third quarter. LR leading 38-3. Back with more. Stay with us. This is LR Football on WSVM Radio. Hey.
Celebrate great with Carolina West Wireless. Great new phones and a great customer experience all on our great nationwide high-speed network. Stop by today and get big savings on select Samsung smartphones, like $350 off the Samsung Galaxy S20 and S20 Plus, and $350 off the Note 20 and Note 20 Ultra. The great savings continue with 4 lines of unlimited data for just $35 a month per line. Celebrate great savings and go stay connected wherever your travels take.
The FM
We got all kind of time still to go. We're 9 minutes to go in the third quarter. LR leading this homecoming tilt 38-3. Limestone getting set to kick it off. They'll kick it to the closed end at Moretz. Still many fans here, but quite a bit still out tailgating from halftime. Bears will get it here. And the kickoff is picked up at the 5-yard line. Weaving his way is Lester. He'll cross the 25, maybe knock down at the 26-yard line, and that's where the LR offense has already scored a couple of touchdowns, or at least the team has scored touchdowns. The offense and the defense has scored here in the third quarter of play to lead it 38-3. Jack, you were part of the festivities last night and yesterday's golf tournament. I had a chance. They had a couple of activities over at Blowing Rock Brewery, one of our fine sponsors on the Bear Sports Network. Ran into some alums and some former teammates who I hadn't seen in over 30 years. Some memories from yesterday's golf tournament and some players.
Well, that's what makes it special. I was able to play the morning round with three players that I was fortunate enough to have coached during my tenure here at Lenoir-Rhyne. And then I played in the afternoon with two players that I had played ball with here at Lenoir-Rhyne during my tenure here as a player. So that's the kind of things that homecoming does. It brings people together and you see folks that you haven't. I met the son of one of the players. Mike Tramp was a player that I played with here at Lenoir-Rhyne. Met his one of his sons who had been a football player, a wide receiver, and an excellent player at Ball State University. Mike's from Ohio and went back to Ohio and lives there. But, you know, those are opportunities that you don't get, seem like, every week. They come along at homecoming most of the time.
And here comes McGee. He's running with the ball, and he has a first down flag down to the 50-yard line. They may bring that one back. Hey, big thank you and a shout-out to Rex Marley, L.R. Bear alum, baseball player. He's down at a golf tournament on his golf trip listening and watching this afternoon. Thanks, Rex, for doing that. And let's see, it's going to be a holding call against the Bears, so bring it back. But, I mean, every time you look up when they hand it off to McGee, you kind of hold your breath, Jack, and you expect a big play.
And that was one of the wide receivers that got called for the hole there. Well, I understand.
No, never.
How you are. You like those wide receivers. That was number 18. Songa Yates, he played a lot last week. We saw him in the second half a lot last week. He got called for holding. And that was the carry right there that would have put McGee over his 160-yard average we were talking about.
One thing I've noticed about these freshmen, a couple of guys out of Vance High School in Charlotte, both are freshmen, both receivers. And there's a pass complete. Willingham delivers it over there to Parsons, where he is just wrestled out of bounds at the 40. It's going to be, though, good enough for a first down. Another Bear first down. They tack on another. First down for the Bears. Marching to the open end here at Moret Stadium. We'll talk about the stadium project, Jack. You guys mentioned it at halftime about what's going on there.
Yeah, I tell you, the stadium itself, the renovation for the stadium, and then what I saw today at the there was a breakfast this morning that I attended, and, boy, I'm telling you, look out. I got caught. But the renovation to Shuford Gymnasium, I was totally impressed. First time I'd seen that. There's going to be a renovation, and it will just, I just can't even explain it to you. It'll be remarkable when they get that done. And then the baseball field and the softball field are also in the works. With the stadium coming next year and then Shuford Gym probably right on the hill. I think we could be surprised how quickly that comes about. Shuford Gym, and I'm not talking about just the gym. I'm talking about the complete building over here. It may look like a completely new building when it's done.
They start on that. It's got to be after, obviously, the basketball season. Incomplete pass.
Well, it wouldn't affect the gym now. It would be, a lot of this is going to be built around.
Yeah.
This is a new building, kind of like the McGahee building, you know, was added on. You know, it's going to have effect on it at a certain point. But, you know, I don't think they would do it while they were doing the stadium. It'd be too much congestion out here in this area. But it would be around and kind of change the side of the building into more like the front of the building.
Yeah, and they have intents of having, like, luxury suites that you look over the basketball court and the football stadium as well. And whenever that happens, there will be a walkway, like, on a second floor, like a terrace.
Yeah.
There were some pictures that I saw. I heard that maybe they're thinking about that's where they would add the Lenoir-Rhyne Sports Hall of Fame.
Yep, they were talking about that too. Yeah, that building renovation would be remarkable. And once all of these things are done, I just can't believe there'd be a Division II school anywhere that would be close in terms of what we would have facility-wise.
Bears get another first down, and McGee has it, and he's running with the ball again. Over the 40, he gets 11 or 12 on the carry. And Dwayne McGee, who's over 150 yards here in this football game, had 200 last week. Bears leading it 38-3 with 6:14 to go in the third.
Beautiful run.
Yeah, beautiful run to the 38 of Limestone.
And great contact there. All of our receivers, our linemen got good contact, held their blocks, and let McGee get through there. And, you know, he's building up toward that 200-yard day again.
First and 10. Hands it off again to McGee, and those linemen are pushing guys down the field. I mean, they're getting a great surge, and some of those linemen, defensive linemen for Limestone, Jack, look like they're on skates.
McGee really does. He just runs with his eyes. I know I've beat that term to death, but let me tell you this. I don't know if there's a better way to explain it. He sees it, and he does it. You know, we were talking about see and do. Coach Painter, a long time ago, he told me, he said, you got to find guys that can see and do. And he can. He can see it, and he can do it. I could see it, but it took me about 30 seconds to do it. It takes him about a split second to do it.
Offensive line doing a wonderful job. They move a couple of tight ends from right to left. Look like they're going to run left. Play action. Willingham back to pass, throwing it downfield incomplete. That front line we mentioned, don't give him enough love. Xavier Jennings, a freshman out of Shelby and Burns High School. Bryce Heidinger is back in there, the redshirt junior out of Raleigh. Ryan Franz has played quite a bit the last few weeks, a big freshman out of Blythewood, South Carolina. Blake Jefferson has been solid in the middle, the sophomore center out of Tucker, Georgia. Isaac Chapman back from injury, the sophomore at guard. Shane Wells has filled in nicely out of Brunswick, Georgia, sophomore. And Ian Brinson, the graduate and senior from Moultrie, Georgia, at right tackle. And they run right side. This is Davis.
First down.
First down on a third and one. And the Bears pick up the first down. Third and short, they try to go deep, Jack, on the incomplete pass. And this time they pick up the first down to the 27.
Yeah, and McGee's back in there. I doubt very seriously if the coach is kind of aware of his stat, but he's got 175 yards rushing right now, averaging 8.3 on 21 carries.
Fourth in the nation in rushing coming into this game. Not going to hurt his average a bit. Here's a pass to the tight end, running with a football, lumbering downfield is Cody Osborne. Freshman out of Windsor, Ohio, transfer from Notre Dame College, and Willingham kind of distributing it to all of the receivers and tight ends today.
That's that little tight end kind of screen that we took. Remember we ran it early in the game, and it was zero, nothing, nada. And we run it again. This time it's executed perfectly. And, of course, Limestone is really back on their heels right now. They're really struggling right now defensively. We're doing so much, throwing so much at them.
There's a running play to McGee. Tries to squirt through there, but they wrap him up and knock him down at the 15. You know, that's going to be a loss on the play, second and 11.
You know, if you really look, I've noticed a couple of times, we have some plays where we pull linemen and kind of get them out in front of McGee. And it seemed like most of the time those plays have not been successful. McGee seems to be a better runner. When everybody blocks their man in front of him, you give him the football and let him do it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They're trying to create something there, pulling linemen, and it didn't seem like those plays worked quite as well for McGee.
Second down, Willingham throwed in the end zone. Man just broke open late was Lester, but Grayson could not deliver it right on the button, so it falls incomplete. Third and 11. Jack, one thing we talked about, so many fans that were here, still a lot of fans that are here this afternoon, but they had over 50 recruits making a visit.
And that's
pretty impressive.
Yes. Well, the great thing is not only the ball game, but the great thing is seeing all of what has gone on.
Yeah.
If they saw this tailgating back here, if they saw the full stands, they understand how important that the athletic programs at Lenoir-Rhyne have become for all the sports, and particularly in football. Kane Crew's in there. We hadn't seen him much.
Yeah. Third down, the veteran out of Brunswick, Georgia. Willingham, plenty of time.
Give it to him. Give it to him. Give it to Kane.
And he dumps it off to Kane Crews at the five, and he is upended down to the 3-yard line. Should be close to the first down. You're right.
Oh, that's wonderful. Kane Crews is like a double red shirt. He's been around forever. Remember I told you I saw the thing? He rushed for something against Catawba back in 2015. I mean, he's been here a long time, just like as a Willingham and Ian Brinson. I think they're probably the longest standing. And he hasn't played a lot with the onset of McGee and Jadis Davis and some of these other guys. He was put in there to block, and he blocked and blocked and blocked, and then he just kind of slipped out, and Grayson had nobody to throw it to, and he finally saw him, and he dumped it to him.
Kane Crews and teammate Preston Joseph, both out of Brunswick, Georgia, and Glenn Academy. And the Bears have had a little bit of a pipeline to that school for a number of years right now. And I think the head coach or one of the coaches at Glenn Academy is Kane's dad. So
yeah.
They've had a nice group of players that have – come to LR over the last decade or so, going back even to the Mike Houston, Fred Goldsmith era as well.
Well, and I would say this, too, about Kane. You know, with the onset of these freshmen and not getting a lay of playing time, you know, he got a lot of playing time a few years ago.
He did.
You
know, he's coming back. He had a knee injury. He had bounced back from a knee injury. Well, I think he torn his ACL a few years back.
I just think a lot of the young man, because he has, I don't know how to say it, he's just hung in there. He's really stayed around the program. He's worked in the program and stayed. And if he's like his dad, maybe he's going to become a coach down the line. That will help him relate to those players like himself that go through difficult times. That will help him relate, you know, as a coach. When you go through things, and if you're coaching later on, you understand what players go through, and it makes a difference.
First and goal now for the Bears.
Kane Cruz is in there at the tailback position. Pistol right behind Willingham. He's going to get it.
Yeah, you called it. He's running right. He gets into the end zone. Kane Cruz gets into the land of milk and honey, which has been, boy, it has been something fruitful today for the Bears.
Look at him. Look at them all go to Kane Cruz.
Yeah. A great locker room guy. I'm certain about that. So he gets into the end zone. 2:48 to go in the third. And that's another LR touchdown. It's the Bears 44 and Limestone 3.
Great blocking. Great job up front. Great job by Mike Jacobs getting Kane Cruz in there and letting him get a score. That was wonderful, Coach.
Waiting for another extra point for Chase Alba. Snap is good. Hold is excellent. And the kick is true. 45-3 in favor of the Bears. 2:48 to go in the third. Back with more. Bears Sports Network presented by MBA Roofing. This is LR Football on WSVM.
Center Street East.
Emergencies don't wait. Get to the hospital. Accidents happen. Get well soon. When it hurts to move forward, tackle your pain. Don't make your health wait. See your doctor. Your health means everything.
Jack Huss. Another Bears score. It's 45-3 now. 2:48 to go here in the third. Bears are going to win, or they are really impressive today, their third straight game after the kickoff, which is dropped in the end zone, so it'll be a touchback. Bears should go on to win their third consecutive game and set up a big showdown match next week with Wingate as the Bears and Bulldogs renew. I would think, Jack, probably the best rival over the last decade or so has been the Bulldogs and the Bears.
Yeah, Carson Newman was in there right with all three at the beginning, and they kind of faded out a little bit as the decade came along, and it basically became Lenoir and Wingate pretty much. Newberry's always tough. Marsh Hill's always tough. Oh, Michael Owen has done an excellent job. They moved the kickoffs around, Juju. We didn't cover as well last week, but he's kicked to the right corner. He's kicked to the left corner. They haven't given the other team an opportunity to say, okay, he's going to kick it here. We're going to return here. He's kicked it right. He's kicked it left and done a really good job.
Trey Stewart just hauled in the pass reception, tackled by the Bear defense, and it's going to be a pickup of almost five. Up to the 29, so second down. We're still in the third quarter here. Late stages.
Marsh Hill game's a final, 31-14.
Marsh Hill stays in the hunt for the South Atlantic Conference Championship. Here's a run up the middle. Stone.
It looked like John Ross May.
It was. Johns Creek, Georgia freshman John Ross May with the stop. Stepped in the hole and stood up the runner. No gain, third down now, third and long now for the Saints.
Notre Dame is 34-14. That game's in the fourth quarter, 34-14 Notre Dame.
think the Bears came on a run blitz.
They're
that
playing
time.
Glenville State.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, they had John Ross May right in the middle of the field, and he stunted just right up the middle. That was a run blitz, no doubt. I didn't know a wide receiver knew what a run blitz was. Good job, bud.
Uh-huh.
They got a little confused there, you know.
Timeout, Limestone.
I kind of feel for Limestone. They look like they can do some things offensively, and then they just kind of hurt themselves. And they actually outweigh the Bears pretty heavily on their offensive linemen. They've got a big bunch of offensive linemen guys that get after it pretty good up there. But they've struggled at times with our defensive line, but so have a lot of people, because our defensive line is pretty much the strength of the team. A lot of older players there that know what's going on. Tusculum 34, Barton 17 in the third quarter.
It was a close game early on, and it looks like the Tusculum has broken that game open. A battle of two former Lenoir Ryan sports information directors. Barton with Johnny Cars and Tusculum with Dom Donnelly.
And we'll be bringing in another one in a year or so.
Yeah.
Emron Henry comes in.
Yes.
Joe Matthews.
Yes, indeed. So this is, you've heard of the cradle of coaches?
Yep, we're the cradle of SID.
Absolutely.
Good call.
Big thank you to our fine sponsors, a great network of outstanding sponsors and contributors to the Lenoir Ryan Sports Network. Great partners. We'll get to a few of them in a minute. Under pressure, quarterback goes down, coming off the edge. I believe that's Houston.
Yeah, he shouldn't get a sack because he grabbed him and lost him, but he fell down. He may get a sack out of that.
I think he will.
Let's see how they score that.
I think he will.
I don't know what, but he took maybe a step after Houston had a hold of him, and then he fell.
Big workout place in the Hickory area, Southside Power and Fitness, owned by our longtime friend and supporter, Big Bear supporter Johnny Moretz. Emerge Ortho, the official sports medicine provider for the Bears again this year. Carolina West Wireless, the official provider. There's a high kick.
No.
And it's going to be a penalty against the Bears running into the kicker.
I tell you what, that is just absolutely tragic. Oh, the punter's not hurt. The guy came through the middle. You watch the replay here. He ran right through the middle untouched and ran right into the kicker and missed the ball. I mean, I don't say how he missed the ball. What's this, Juju? He missed the ball.
Three guys in the middle of the field.
Yeah, but watch him. He runs right between them. Nobody touches him. Look at that. Boom. And he missed the ball.
He didn't put his hands up.
Yeah. Well, he didn't have to. The ball should have hit him in the stomach. He had to be the kicker's right-footed, so he had to be just a little bit to the kicker's left because he hit him, and the ball came off the kicker's right foot and just went way down the field. Just a very, very unusual situation. I don't see how he missed it. I mean, if you run right into where the kicker, you have to run to the kicker's foot, correct?
No.
You're not going to block it if you're not on the kicker's foot side.
Either that or you want to be a couple of feet out in front of the kicker's foot, right?
But he got turned loose right up the middle, and he ran into the kicker's right side and missed the kicker's foot side. You had to go to his foot side. That ball would have been blocked and gone in the end zone. Bears had another touchdown.
Kicker slow getting up. That's Austin Kemp, by the way, redshirt junior.
Yeah, that was an excellent kick, yeah.
Out of Liberty, South Carolina. He knew he was going to get hammered, and he had a nice, high, long kick. But Limestone's going to get the penalty, roughing the kicker as he's being helped off the field, and it's going to be a first down as they mark it in the middle of the field at the 37.
All right, I learned something.
Wait.
Statistically.
Okay.
There's a sack solo and a sack assist. So it looks like Houston may have got – he's got one sack and two sack assists, so he gets total for two sacks. They must be worth a half a sack.
Yeah.
Okay. So they may have given him a sack assist when the guy fell down. I don't see anybody else on here that picked up a sack on.
There's a running play, and Limestone trying to go on the sweep. Met right there. It's going to be a loss on the play of one, second and 11. Our esteemed producer over there, Danny Akosha, maybe Danny knows what a sack and a half sack is. Do you have any idea, Danny? No? Okay. I should say executive producer.
Well, you would think when the sack, the first guy there gets the sack, and anybody that comes in after that, maybe right on top of that, would get the sack assist. We're going to go into the fourth quarter with a slim 45-3 lead here over the Limestone Saints. And you know, I feel for the quarterback. He hasn't played particularly poorly. He just hadn't had a lot of help going on, especially outside with his receivers.
Three quarters are in the books here at the 80th homecoming in LR history, and it's all Bears. 45-3 over Limestone. Back with more. This is LR Football on WSVM Radio.
Quality works.
Doesn't matter who you are, Everett has you covered. Proud sponsor of the LR Bears.
If you play hard, if you use your feet to chase fitness goals, if you stand all day at work, introducing True Energy Infrared Technology Socks. These may be the best socks you ever wear. Our yarn is infused with infrared nanoparticles. Your body's natural heat ignites these tiny particles, producing infrared energy that improves circulation and stimulates cellular recovery. It's not magic, it's rocket science. The perfect sock for your active life, for fitness, performance, recovery. Proven innovation to ignite your true energy.
All right, back here as we start the fourth quarter of play. Limestone with the football, trailing 45-3. Quarterback drops the snap. Bemis just runs right back up the middle and is tackled on a third down and long. And it's going to bring up third down now. It's going to be third and about 12. Jack, we got a clarification on this sack thing. It's considered an assist, right? If both players tackle the quarterback, do they give him the business, tackle him, or do they just hit him hard? Do they wrestle him and give him a noogie? But if they hit him both at the same time, they both get a half assist.
I'm with you on that. Whatever. Okay. We don't have to make those determinations.
No,
thank
we don't.
Goodness. Newberry's up 7-3 early against Carson Newman.
I mean, the fact that Carson Newman has scored this early
yeah.
is amazing.
That's a
after
good thing.
Seeing that game
well,
last week.
They may have recovered a fumble on the 1 yard line.
Or something. A couple of other scores around in the region. A couple of finals are in. Sac, Wingate, who the Bears play next week, beat Wise today, Virginia Wise, at Virginia Wise, 48-21. They bounce back after their loss to Barton last week and do it impressively today. Not Bowie State, but Morris Hill leading Catawba, 31-14. That is now a final. It was Tusculum now leading Barton at Tusculum, 41-17, and number two ranked Valdosta State leading Mississippi College. They gained 13-0 in the first half.
Bowie State's 27-7. You got that one. Did you get that one? Yeah, 27-7 now. Looks like Bowie State and Shawan. I wonder if they have a championship game.
They have had in the past, but Shawan's lost back-to-back games. They've lost.
Well,
two.
If they're in, I just wonder if they're in the same division, though. If they're in the same division, they won't play each other again. But if they're not, maybe they would play again.
They played already. Yeah,
I'm saying maybe they'll play again if they have a divisional, if they're in the different divisions. Oh, by the way, I probably shouldn't say this on the air because I don't know for a fact, but I thought Kim Pate this morning in her remarks to us and. Said that the divisional system was coming.
Divisional.
And it may be the North Carolina schools may be grouped together as much as possible, leaving us playing, you know, Wingate, Catawba, Mars Hill, and some of those schools every year.
Barton. Back to pass. Bemis down the field and throws it. Caught. Oh, dropped. Had it for a minute, rolled over and lost the handle. Would have had a deep first down to the 38 of LR. Nice throw and a catch, nearly a catch by the Saints, but it'll fall incomplete, third and 12.
I feel bad for the quarterback. I mean, he threw a beautiful ball right on the money, and he's had several balls dropped. That was a big play in the first down for Limestone. But, you know, when things are going against you and poorly, those are things that that's hard to coach. You work on, you know, you were a receiver. You work on catching the ball every day. every day in practice, you spend probably two-thirds of practice catching footballs.
Yeah.
And then in a game, the ball drops and, you know.
Punter back in there. Fair catch called for and made by the Bears, Ryan Carter. And the punter was back in there, Jack, 97, Austin Camp. So apparently he is okay. Had a nice high kick.
Yeah, that was a beautiful punt.
Yeah, inside the 20.
Gunnar Anderson looks like coming in at quarterback. Figured that was probably going to happen. Probably going to see a little more of Jadis Davis.
He's in there.
Yep. And there's – oh, they're going to put both of them in there, 25.
Jacoby Lane. Whose brother is a defensive end for the Bears.
Yeah.
Who transferred in from Purdue, I believe. That is Willie Lane.
You may still see most of – it is. Looks like most of the starting offensive linemen are still in there.
This is Lane running with the ball, showing some speed, getting on the outside, flag down.
Going to get called out there for a
wide receiver.
That'd
have been a 12-yard pickup.
Hole.
Yeah, it was a 12-yard pickup in a first down, but they're going to call it back after a penalty against LR. And the Bears have another running back, Jack, that I think maybe one or two that they like that they're going to redshirt.
Yeah, I'll tell you, the Bears have some, you know, they have some excellent running backs, and I don't know if any of them would they would consider being moved or they would even consider moving them, but they got a wealth of running backs. There's three right now. You saw Jacoby Lane right there, what he can do. We know what Jadis Davis can do, and we know what Dwayne McGee can do. So, you know, if they've got any more that are waiting in the wings, it's going to be an interesting offseason.
Winter Haven, Florida is the home of Lane, who has the ball now, showing speed and following his blockers. Jefferson out in front, the big center for the Bears. And Lane picks up good yardage up over the 20 to the 25, and it's going to be a pickup of about 10, so it's going to bring up second and five, so the Bears are back ahead of the chains.
Yep, and he just hit that hole so quick.
Yeah.
He has, I mean, McGee and Jadis Davis are not slow, but this kid is just quick. He's got those, but he's running full speed after about three steps. You know, McGee's and Davis are more of gliders. They kind of glide around back in there. This kid just hits it and goes.
Lane carries it again, running right side, and he does get the first down. Pick up a five more to the 30. You know, you mentioned Lane. He's out of Winter Haven, Florida. Kissimmee, Florida is the home of Dwayne McGee. There must be some Florida connection down there with the Bear coaches. Both of those schools and those areas are right around the Orlando area.
Well, they also got a lot of those 5'7 running backs that, you know, people look at. And now, Jacoby Lane's 5'9. He's taller, but he only weighs 140. He's not a big guy.
That and the fact that there aren't too many Division II schools now, except for West Florida, I think, down in Florida. Another running play for Lane.
Look,
bouncing off a couple of guys before he is thrown backwards. Got up to the line of scrimmage, maybe a gain of one.
Yeah, he realized he's a different type of runner. Size-wise, he's similar, but he's a quick runner. He's a quick guy. He gets in there quick and then makes his move. And Davis and McGee particularly are gliders. They just kind of – they hit in there, and then they kind of just glide through here and there. And then they turn it on when they get into the – or get past the line of scrimmage when they turn on their speed. This kid's running full speed after about two steps.
He needs to get on the meal plan at 140 pounds.
Look at that.
He's got speed, and he's through the hole and has the first down up to midfield. Lane with a carry. It goes for 19 yards. And a Bear first down into Limestone territory.
And I tell you, I am I'm going to hand it to the secondary of Limestone. They have made a lot of tackles when they did not give up on the play. A lot of defensive backs would give up on that play. Number 27 that made that tackle, he was well behind the play, but he didn't give up on it. Raekwon Ryan, he just kept – he kept after it, and that play was going for a touchdown if he doesn't make a second effort play to get to that. Their secondary has done that all day long.
This time, Gunnar Anderson on the keeper on the RPO, and he'll pick up about five.
I believe that was an RPR. It was a run pass run. He wasn't going to throw that ball.
No.
You know, right now with 11 minutes to go and us on a good offensive drive, I don't know. We may see Gunnar throw it here in a minute. But right now, they're going to work on that running game.
Call it a gain of four, second and six into Limestone territory. Bears are just running the old-fashioned power sweep, aren't they?
Well, they run a lot of just stuff where they block straight ahead, you know, just like this.
And the back Lane tries to cut outside, He gains a couple of yards, brings up third and five.
Now, when we get in that tight formation, it's a triple formation. They got three receivers to the left, but they're all right at the end of the line of scrimmage. There's no wide receiver. When we get in that formation, people expect runs, so you know they're going to. Of course, we got some play passes out of it, I'm sure. But when they expect run, they're going to get people up and crowd the line of scrimmage and really go after you. We haven't thrown it out of that formation that I could remember today, and that makes a difference.
There's Anderson back to pass under pressure, and he's going to go down.
Yeah, he took too long to make up his mind. Great job. That little 140-pound back right there.
Lane.
Yeah, Jacoby Lane. He blocked that big kid coming in. He just hit him right in the kneecaps and took him down. The sack actually came from the backside, and Gunner waited just a little bit too long to make his mind up what he was going to do.
Simeon Kennedy, a freshman defensive lineman, a 290-pounder out of Goose Creek, South Carolina, had the sack, and that'll force Owen to kick it. Steps into it at his own 35, and over end kick.
Oh, yeah, good
bounce.
And
it's going to be inside the 20.
Going down there.
And rolls down to about the 13-yard line. I was going to mention that last on third down. Bears had something in the formation, Jack. They had two receivers on the far side. Both are freshmen from Vance High School in Charlotte. I don't know, LR's, you know, down through the years, they've recruited Charlotte. They've had some really good players from Charlotte. But I never recall two receivers from one high school.
Yeah.
Lining up to play on the same play.
That's a rarity, especially when you think about the situation. In Charlotte, they got a lot of schools that can throw the football.
Yeah.
You know, we got Grayson Willingham from around that area. He's not right in Charlotte, but he was in that area playing against Charlotte schools. And they've got some athletes down there that can throw the football.
So this is where I guess there was a penalty against. Must have been a 5-yard penalty against Limestone.
No, it's still 13-yard line. That's where the ball rolled dead.
Okay. I thought it was the 18. But
no,
okay.
They just I don't know. They just a little extra time there. They didn't call a timeout. I didn't see any kind of timeout signal from the officials.
Quick pass, screen to the receiver outside, and the Bears come up and meet him and knock him back. Percy King on the stop on the wide receiver screen, loss of one.
Plethora of new names in there. Alvin James was in there, number 7 at defensive back that time. And A veritable threat. Is that number 80 out there at defensive back?
It looks like it. It's either 80 or 30.
Is it 30? All right, Chris Moore, he's listed as a fullback. It's not him.
It may be Jordan Blankney.
Is it? No.
A senior out of Wingate University.
Yeah, 20. 20. Yeah. That's what it is. It's 20 out there.
Transfer from Wingate.
You know, we saw him play some. I remember his name. He's played some in the past.
There's a running play up the middle.
Number 14.
And the Bears pick him up and knock him backwards. Austin Cagle. Nope. Check that. Lakin Nettles, a freshman defensive back out of Atlanta, Georgia.
Boy, he was up close to the line of scrimmage for a DB. Well, he's playing safety.
I mean, if you got 84 freshmen on the team, there's no wonder why a lot of these players have double numbers, you know?
Yeah.
Repeat numbers.
Yeah, when you got over 100, you got to start doing it again. I asked Coach Painter one time, I said, you know, why have you never retired any numbers? He said, if we retired numbers, we'd have been in triple digits when we only had 40 players on the team. You think about it, some of the greats that played at Lenore Ryan, even in the last 10 years, we'd be out of numbers.
Back to pass, under pressure.
You can't miss him.
And he missed him. The quarterback gets out of there, and he throws it and completes it to the 20, up to the 21, shy of the first down, but a good scramble by the quarterback for Limestone, and he almost had his head taken off. Beamish did.
That was a great
play. Wow, it was.
Yeah, he was under heavy duress back there, and we just didn't tackle him. You know, problem was that they had such a long way to go, they didn't get the first down.
You can tell Limestone's playing with effort, and that's something I would guess from their program standpoint that you can build off of.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing about it. And I haven't looked at their roster like I have at ours, but I bet you they got a lot of freshmen and sophomores that are, you know, on this lineup as well. And they dressed close to 80 players today.
Here comes another punt by Kemp.
Off the side of the foot if we get a good bounce.
And they get a good bounce back in – in favor of LR inside the 40 down to the 39. So it's going to be
20,
not too
16,
far.
16-yard punt. No, 13-yard punt. Excuse me. From the 26 to the 39. I checked the marker before they moved it. 13-yard punt. We've got a TV timeout, Jew.
Okay. So we'll take a TV timeout here on the radio and on the stream. Thank you for listening and watching this afternoon. It's homecoming here at LR, and we'll be right back. Bears lead it 45-3 on the Bears Sports Network on WSVM Radio.
Moret Stadium is an iconic part of LR Athletics. Hosting games, tailgating, marching band competitions, sports camps, and graduation ceremonies, the stadium serves as a valued focal point for the greater Hickory area. The time has come to renovate the stadium to allow LR to continue to offer our student athletes, fans, and the community an exceptional experience.
Paramount Kia in Hickory. We want to see you driving a new Kia or, hey, a quality pre-owned Kia. We've got a huge selection of new and pre-owned Kias. You got to get to Paramount Kia in Hickory, Highway 70, ParamountKia.com.
Here as we return to action, Bears have it at the Limestone 39. Here's a running play by Davis. Anderson in at quarterback for this second series for the Bears. The Alexander Central High School near Taylorsville, North Carolina native. And he hands it to Davis, who picks up 2, 2nd and 8 here as the Bears trying to continue their offense prowess here this afternoon, 45-3 over the Saints.
Back many years ago, I always think about these situations when we get in here. We'd be saying, well, this is one of them times for the Bears to put together a 6-minute drive and close this game out. Back in the wishbone days.
2nd and 8. I'm sure they'll keep it on the ground. This time it's Anderson on the keeper up the middle.
Uh-oh, Gunner's helmet came off. He's going to have to come out.
King Cruz comes in, checks in. Gunner's going to stay in there. Oh, here he comes.
I thought his helmet came off. He slipped it back on real quick. Now, they can call timeout and get him back in the game.
And they're going to bring in Trevor Shue, who is a long time backup quarterback for the Bears. Oh, check that. That's Austin Cagle, redshirt sophomore out of Clayton, North Carolina. Get his first snap, number 14. 6'1", 200-pounder.
I think Shue came in at wide receiver, didn't he? Did he come in at wide receiver?
May have. And Cagle throws a pass.
Yep, his first collegiate pass, and he's 1 for 1 for a minus 2.
So bring up 4th down for the Bears, and I think Mike Jacobs, you're going to call on the punting unit here. They're just going to run the clock down.
Yeah,
call a timeout and then run another play.
No, he won't call timeout. I'd take the 5-yard penalty. Unless Michael Irwin hits a great punt, he's probably going to kick it into the end zone anyway. So you got to back you up to the 30. I mean to the 40. What, 42? Yeah. Looks better punting from the 42 than the 37. Give your punter 5 extra yards to work with.
Another freshman in there playing at wide receiver is Hickory High School product, Malachi Sumner, who had a big play against Tusculum on the special teams, came away with a fumble recovery on the punt, Jack, and that set up the Bears, I believe, for the go-ahead touchdown when the Bears got 10 points off of turnovers by Tusculum in the fourth quarter. Final 6 minutes of the game, and Sumner was a big part of that, recovering a punt, recovering a fumble on a punt. He's now out there, was out there, wide receiver, and the Bears are going to kick this away.
A little low there to number 60, Tyler Keaton.
Yes.
6 feet, 225. He's a grad student. He's been around a while. He's the long snapper right here.
And his brother is a freshman, also a long snapper. Both out of Reagan High School in Winston-Salem.
Don't back up. And he did.
He did. Just not supposed to feel the punt inside the 10, but he did.
Well, he signaled it to 10, and he backed up two steps. You know, if you signal it to 10 and it goes over your head, you get the heck out of the way because you don't want it to bounce backwards and hit you.
I heard the sound, moo, and I looked out on the program. Number 91, Davis Moose, redshirt sophomore out of Albemarle. You know, I'm thinking.
Kin to the Moose family.
I'm thinking, yes.
Got to be. Their Albemarle is their hometown, if I am not mistaken.
South Stanley High School. 5'10", 250-pound redshirt sophomore.
Chuan is 28-18 now with Elizabeth City.
Out of Decatur, Georgia.
Just slipped the tight end out in the flat. Nothing fancy. The Bears just didn't cover it. You got a lot of second line guys in there that haven't seen a lot of action in the secondary, so things look a little different to them.
Here's a pass over here that is complete for line.
Years ago, his redshirt sophomore, Dean Braxton, 6'3", 188. He's a good-looking kid, but, you know, I don't think the other kid, the freshman kid they started, did a bad job. This kid just got a good arm on him. He's got a little bit more of a full throwing motion. He got a wind-up left-handed baseball pitcher kind of throwing motion.
And it's knocked down. Big paw good going job. Up for the Bears is Devin Hibbett, freshman linebacker out of Bedford, Ohio. Makes, I believe, he's another transfer from Notre Dame College. I believe, and it's going to bring up third down, 3 minutes and 40 seconds left in this football game. It's been all Bears. They led from the outset and have tacked on some scores here in the second half. They scored two touchdowns, I think, in the first 5 minutes of the second half, and routing the Saints here 45-3.
Yeah, the ball game's pretty much been over since almost halftime, but the Bears got two quick scores, and that kind of put it on ice in the early in the third. But, you know, this Limestone group right here, look at this quarterback run. They're still – there's no give up in them. They're playing hard. They're doing – you know, Coach Turk has got them at least, you know, in bad situations, making a great effort, and that's all you can ask.
So Braxton with the quarterback keeper scrambles for the first down. And it'll be marked at the 40. Ball's on the far right hash. The sun going down in the press box. Jack, one more time maybe? One more time in the press. This 30-plus-year-old press box here at Moret Stadium.
There's no.
Pass incomplete.
It's the sun.
Seniors and upperclassmen. But, I mean, I must have called 20 guys already today that have contributed somehow that were true freshmen or first-year players.
Yeah. The depth, at least, you know, there's – oh, that's an excellent job. Look at that missed tackle.
And a pass and a completion and a first down for the Saints goes into LR territory at the 43.
Yeah, missed tackle there by that defensive back, you know. The Bears have had their problems tackling with this unit a little bit, and you know, it's, I guess, pretty much the same group of receivers and backs. I don't see a lot of changes that Limestone has made, and there's no need for them to. This is where they're getting some work. This is where they're getting some reps.
Quazdu is the one that missed the tackle. Here's a pass over here, and it's completed. Inside the 30, running with the football, tackled from behind out of the 20, and another big play by Limestone. That's going to be a pickup of 23 and into the red zone of the Bears.
You know, if I'm the quarterback for Limestone, it started Beamish. I'm over there thinking, I wonder why they didn't leave me in there against this group. this group's not pressuring like that other group did.
It fell incomplete, in and out of the hands of Cody Jones. Stops the clock with just under a minute and a half to go in the ball game.
You know, number 81 there is an interesting player. He's the one that caught that pass coming out of the end zone down there and ran it up the field, made a nice gain out of it. He is a 6'4", 210-pound freshman from Raleigh, played at Southeast Raleigh High School. He's a good-looking kid. You know, I thought he was a tight end, but he's been lining up as a wide receiver.
And here's a handoff and a run play, and the Bears stuff it.
He's not a blocker. They just had him in the lead blocking right there. He didn't particularly care for that. He's a wide receiver.
He olated, as they say.
If you want me to block, put me out there one-on-one with a defensive back. Don't expect me to block this defensive end when I'm coming across the line of scrimmage.
Bears make a play up there, number 97, I think, you know, on the stop. And boy, Solomon Riggins, another freshman, Hampton, Georgia. Loss of one, third and 11.
They're not milking the, I mean, they are milking the clock. They're trying to score. I don't know if they'll use their timeouts or not. Well, they don't have any. I don't remember them using, but they may have in this. They might not have reset it at the half.
Thrown in the end zone then. Under pressure, quarterback rolling
receiver
left.
Fell down.
And so he's going to try to run out of bounds. Tripped inside the 20, shy of the first. It's going to bring up fourth and five now, fourth and six.
You know,
for the Saints.
Braxton's, he's 6'3", but he looks taller than that out here playing, doesn't he? He looks really tough. But 6'3", pretty good size for a quarterback, 188 pounds. But the receiver he could have thrown to that was going to be open just fell down. The turf monster got him down there about the 9-yard line and didn't have anybody throw it to.
I didn't know receivers could do that. I knew always receivers could block. They were excellent blockers. They were able to keep their balance because a lot of those guys probably took ballet when they were growing up. So they should have good balance. They should not be falling down on the turf.
Oh, I agree with that. I wonder what happened with the clock here. Delay of game. Coach took a long time putting that play in. I don't know what the deal was. It's fourth and seven. Now it's going to be fourth and 12. I don't know why he took so long getting that play in.
Brian Turk is the third-year head coach for Limestone. He comes from, I believe he was a former player and assistant graduate coach at South Carolina for the Gamecocks when Steve Spurrier was the head coach there. He's been on board. He was the, I think, offensive coordinator for a year or two, Jack. But, Limestone historically have gone through head coaches. I mean, one of their head coaches is now an assistant for the Chicago Bears.
They're getting ready to get another one. They're getting ready to get back-to-back. Clock's run out again. I don't understand what.
I mean, why even?
Well, he didn't give the play. I watched him, the signal guys. He didn't give the play to his signal guys until, there was about less than 10 seconds on the clock on the play clock.
Is there a reason why they even care at this point? But we'll see. Here it is on fourth down. Pass is knocked away. Good play by the Bears. Defensive back over there, K.J. Makins. Freshman out of Greenwood, South Carolina. Another pipeline of players coming in from Greenwood, even going back to the days of former quarterback Evan Sims, who played for the Bears back in 2015 and 2014, starting quarterback when the Bears went undefeated. In that year, he helped the Bears do that. But he was also from Greenwood, South Carolina, another famous quarterback from Appalachian State. Helped win a couple of national championships is from Greenwood. Mr. Edwards.
Yeah, I was Amante.
Yeah.
I was trying to remember the kid that this is way back. He went to Alabama. He was a Greenwood quarterback. He went to Alabama, and he played defensive back when he got down there. And was a good defensive back, but they said in high school he could throw with either hand. And he would sprint out right, throw right hand, sprint out left, and throw left hand. But he played defensive back at Alabama.
Wow. And there you have it. Clock runs out. Bears win it 45-3 as they win their 80th homecoming tilt here this afternoon. Bears scored early and often, led big at the half, and tacked on some scores in the second half and win going away to improve to 5-2 on the season. And the Bears do it really smartly, running the football and strong defense, win their third straight game. 45-3, final score as they knock off the Saints of Limestone. We'll come back with the post-game show on this happy homecoming Saturday. Juju Phillips with Jack Huss. Stay with us. Final score once again, Bears win it 45-3. Back with more. This is Bears football on WSVM Radio. a happy homecoming Saturday afternoon. Everything in favor of the Bears today as they win 45-3, knocking off Limestone here this afternoon for their third straight victory. Go to 5-2 on the season. Jack, as we look at the homecoming, before we get to all the activities prior to the game and everything, but today the Bears score early and often. What are some things that you saw that you liked about this growth of this football team today?
Well, the Bears, the last 3 weeks in playing good football, they've done what I think Coach Jacobs intended to do all along, and we've done it well. We've run the football, hard-nosed football, a lot, and the play-action pass opens up because of that, and we've thrown the ball effectively. And even when we throw a first-down drop-back pass, people are looking for the run, and that helps a little bit too. So I think the Bears have accomplished exactly what they wanted to from the get-go. We just didn't do it quite as well early on in the season. Now we're sort of getting the hang of it. We're doing it well, and it comes at the right time because the stretch of the next three games, particularly the next two now, and I know Barton's, I believe, is looking at the score here. It's 41-17. Tusculum is beating up on Barton. You think, well, we beat Tusculum. But Barton at Barton beat Wingate last week. So we got to go down there. Okay. So we know it's going to be a tough contest. We've got to go to Wingate next week, which we knew it before the schedule came out was going to be a tough contest. So the Bears have put themselves in a position to keep playing as hard as they can for two more weeks. And then when we come back for Catawba, if we can win the next two, then we can sit back and say, well, this, if, and that, and see what happens. But we're not in that position. But we've played good football the last 3 weeks, offensively doing what we needed to do, defensively playing the way I think we felt like we could play all year, which we hadn't done as well. We defended the pass better. We defended the run exceptionally well. They were only able to gain let me see what their total rushing is right here. They had 24 rushes for minus 12 yards. So, the Bears did exactly what they needed to do, dominate on defense, run the football, play action pass, get the job done. Good kick, good solid kicking game, too. The only bad kick all day was a missed field goal by
Elbaugh early on, yeah.
Yeah, and that was it.
This team seems to be, after you mentioned, everybody in the South Atlantic Conference at least.
Kind of look at Mars Hill, they're kind of sneaking up on people, yeah. Like you said.
Yeah.
They've got some games to play against some good opponents, too. But, and here's Newberry hanging around. They're 14-3 over Carson Newman now in the second quarter. They'll probably win that one. They're at home. But, the Wise game is the one that hurts the Bears the most right now, looking back. Newberry is a game that people say, hey, traditionally Newberry's a pretty good team. But Wise is getting whacked now by some people, and we were not able to go up there and handle them. And, it was just not a good game, and they played exceptionally well. I was very impressed with them when we played them. I was very impressed with Newberry when we played them, and both of them were close ball games. So the Bears got a good football team. But we can't worry about anything for the national situation or for the conference until we get to the Catawba game, and then – that game could have a whole lot of meaning. It'll have a whole lot of meaning anyway, because it will be the 100th meeting. We didn't get it in the spring. It will be the 100th meeting between Catawba and Lenoir Ryan, and that'd be a great one to win.
And it should be the – it could be, and I'll say for sure, but it could be the last game in the old Moret Stadium before the renovations could begin as early as – October, November 15th. So
November,
we'll see.
As soon as that game, barring anything that a playoff situation, construction
game,
will begin. Yeah, and I think we mentioned this last week that Kim Pate told me that the new lights will be installed here in January, even with construction going on otherwise. So, there'll be new lights for lacrosse season in the spring.
As you look at the stats, and we'll wrap things up here before we go, let's run down some of the stats that stood out to you. Last week, the Bears had over 700 yards of offense against Carson Newman. How'd they end up today?
Well, Beamish, the young quarterback for Limestone, was 13-27 for 146 yards. Braxton, the quarterback that came in, was 4-8 for 58 yards. So, it wasn't too bad. Now, Beamish got sacked four times. A couple of them were his fault. A couple of them was breakdowns in the offensive line. But, Dwayne McGee, again, 22 carries, 178. Had a loss of four, net 174, two touchdowns. Jacoby Lane carried six times for 44 yards. And Jadis Davis carried six times for 41 yards. And Willingham had two carries for 15 yards, one of them a big run that helped set up a touchdown. The Bears overall, you know, time of possession, we're up 32 minutes to 27 minutes, something like that. 8 of 13 on third down, you know. We held Limestone to 415, pretty much what you would expect. A pretty dominant game statistically and in all the other areas for the Bears. But you would expect that because we knew coming in at 0-5 and on their third quarterback, it was going to be a struggle for Limestone.
So the Bears go to 5-2, win their third straight. Next week, go on the road at Wingate to take on the Bulldogs, who won big today as they knocked off their opponent this afternoon, Virginia Wise, as you mentioned, Jack. 48-21 the final there on the road. Also, Mars Hill, impressive win at home, knocking off Catawba. Also in the South Atlantic Conference, Tusculum rolling over Barton, 41-17. Newberry at last report,
14-3.
Ahead of Carson Newman. That game is being played at Newberry, and those games are in the South Atlantic Conference today. So a big happy homecoming today. Bears celebrate with a big fundraiser, golf tournament yesterday and last night. Homecoming indeed for five new Hall of Famers into the Sports Hall of Fame. Now about 158, I think, members into the Sports Hall of Fame. Welcomed in a couple of football players, including Smith Sharp. Former coach Mike Houston was part of this year's class. Just a good all the way around Hall of Fame ceremonies. Yep. And money raised at the golf tournament. I mean, just a great weekend, and a way to keep it and cap it off with this big win today. And there you have it, fans that are watching on the stream. The first ever authorized history of Lenoir Ryan football. We had David Stevens on at halftime, the author of the book. And, I mean, you couldn't have asked for a better weekend. The weather was absolutely spectacular. Perfect. Not a cloud in the sky. And Bears cap it off with a big win today.
Yeah, it's a great homecoming day. If you look behind us, you know, usually by this time people are starting breaking down their tents and everything. They're not breaking them down in a hurry today. A lot of people are hanging around because it is homecoming, and it gives you that opportunity to see people and to run into people. You mentioned you ran into some teammates you hadn't seen in 30 years. I mean, that's what homecoming is all about. And homecoming at Lenoir Ryan is a very, very special day. I hope those of you that are out there that are listening, that next year you'll make a plan to come back, because when you come here and you just bump into people and you say, oh golly, I haven't seen so and so and whatever, and you go over and start talking, and you know, it's just a great time. So, you know, people had if you had a great time at Lenoir Ryan while you were here as a student, come back, you'll have an even better time now.
Student experience, that's what they're always talking about. And we just heard Kenny Chesney saying we got to get along, and that's what the Bears did today. They got along and got a win as they knock off Limestone 45-3 here this afternoon. And we are glad that you were a part of it, either be it by the stream or listening to us on our flagship station, WSVM Radio. That'll do it. That'll wrap things up here this afternoon from Moret Stadium. Don't forget, the Bears in action on the road at Wingate next Saturday afternoon. Bears and Bulldogs, hope you'll be a part of the Bears Sports Network. For my Hall of Fame partner, Jack Huss, Danny Nikosha, and, of course, the entire crew here at Moret Stadium, I'm Juju Phillips saying thanks a lot for listening. Until next time, so long, everyone. You've been listening to Lenoir Ryan Football on WSVM Radio.